Sparks in here, truth in here. Witness tales of us hustlers, you know? This is just the life we lead. This is the life we lead.
Yo, a million sparks, young gun. My life as an adolescent set out goals to do something. Other guys try to stand in my way like brick walls, so I kept guns in the palm, recite scripts from song. I should fear no man but God, so Lord knows we can get it on. Guns baptized, chest and pride. Clearing my conscience in the liquor store with a fifth of Thunderbird. And I be guzzling hard, playing the corners with a washed up old heads, chant tunes by the whispers. Same corner where I banged out with niggas. Cops ride by and grit on us. If they grab us, the semblance, one of them newsy neighbors done snitched on us. Hey, this game juicy got me puffing loosies. Every 2 days, interrogated by the police. See, this life I live costs more than your rollies. Money costs my homie nook his whole life. You heard me, When he would say it was easy, he loved me like a brother. Now he's gone, I find it difficult to talk to his mother. I mean, what do you say to a woman that just lost her only son to the game and the gun and said, mommy, I'ma ride for him. The look that she gave me like sparks, you got some nerve. Most of these niggas don't keep their words, now I'm under pressure. Cause I can't break that type of promise, y'all niggas paint that picture. Risk me your freedom on a strip of memories of him. The time he made you laugh, the time he bust that gat when the other niggas ran. I really stat, a million sparks, nigga, holla back, Yo, and this life you're not promised tomorrow, so take the bitter with the sweet and maintain. In these vicious streets, carry your heat and keep your mind on your money. Life's a gamble, everybody got a number, homie. Tales of a hustle. And this life you're not promised tomorrow, so take the bitter with the sweet and maintain. In these vicious streets, carry your heat and keep your mind on your money. Life's a gamble, everybody got a number, homie.
I'm
tales
back to
of
the
a hustle.
With it. Wait, let me clear that up. I'm back to the blocks that you get when your block did it. Your when that hot water in that pot hit it. Get large with a little water when you pot whip it. I send coke to you late night scramblers. Sling coke to you late night scramblers. Go broke, sling soap to you late night scramblers. No joke, I'm a crook, cat hooks, broke late night gamblers. Look, you lose limbs when you fuck with him. That B.I. strapped and high, FBI all on my back when I trap the guy. Got niggas in all black wanna snatch my pies. Never that, too many gaps, too many guns, too many vests. Tough guys, not too many left. Where they at? Dead gone, locked behind bars in jail. I know I ain't too far from hell. I spit the devil these bars in hell. Dog, I've been through it, son. Look at my scars and tell. Catch Mac in the Chevy truck, slightly tinted. No excuses on who might be in it. You know passenger side, twisting backwards, slightly spinning. Crack the window, the endo, slightly sinning. Splasher, haze and hash, lightly blending. Put the pressure on niggas who might be timid. Like, you got like a minute to put the cash in his bag. And your ass might be in it in small pieces. Snatch your family up. I start from your tall nephews to small nieces, bitches.
And this life you're not promised tomorrow, so take the bitter with the sweet and maintain. And these vicious streets, carry your heat and keep your mind on your money. Life's a gamble, everybody got a number on me. Tales of a hustle. And this life you're not promised tomorrow, so take the bitter with the sweet and maintain. And these vicious streets, carry your heat and keep your mind on your money. Life's a gamble, everybody got a number on me. Tales of a hustle.
All right, y'all, what up?
What's up with you?
What's going on? This your boy 95Norf back in the building, holding y'all down. It's a Sunday afternoon. Y'all know how we get it popping at ABM101.com, ABM101 Radio. I'm here, I'm in the building, and I got some special guests in the building, as always. You know, most of the time when I come up and I jump on the air, because I got some big talk I want to talk to y'all about. Some people that want to, you know what I'm saying, like make they mark in the game. You feel what I'm saying? So I don't just have anybody up here. But with that being said, I'm going to let them introduce themselves. What up? Talk to the people.
Yo, this is BL in the building. What's up?
Yo, it's Miss Porter dripping like water. You already know.
Got shot on Montgomery in the back.
What's
shot
up?
Montgomery, we got Yamba.
Y'all got clean cuisine.
I like that.
Queen.
Queen.
Residential cleaning, commercial cleaning, event decor and catering.
Oh, well, I need you.
Queen,
you clean cuisine?
Yeah. Clean cuisine, yes. I do food.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, that's dope.
That's what's up. That's what's up. So what's up? What's up, Porter? What's going on? What's
popping? We had a whole map, you know, everything mapped out or whatever. But now, you know, we freelancing.
I mean, so it's all good.
We just going. We gonna get right to it. I don't even want to waste no time. Who's this? Right. Oh, my drone shot. I don't get no signal here. Shout out to T-Mobile. Okay. One of. Go ahead. She in the radio station. Let him know. Talk to him like you talk to him when you home. Listen. I watched some of her lives and I was like, yeah. She has this dope personality. I was like, you know how people gotta be fig and made up. Like, what do I say? She don't have that. So I was like, yo, you're perfect. You know, they go like, well, what does she do? She don't need to do anything. She need to be herself. And it works. It works. Let them know where you at. ABM 101, tune in, download the app. Yep,
download the app. ABM 101.
Like I said, if I come, I'm bringing some people with me. I'm bringing some people with me.
Yeah. Go to ABM101.com. It's live right now, ABM101.com. Shout out Canada. I know y'all tuned in crazy. I just checked the stats. So shout out to Canada. They always support real crazy, real heavy. You know, I always sit there and make sure I shout y'all out. So what's up, Canada?
What's up, Canada?
What's that conversation
gonna be like?
We could touch base on domestic violence.
Yeah.
We wanted to touch base on that.
Okay.
We wanted to touch base on physical abuse, verbal abuse. Okay. You know, all those are forms of abuse. And we just wanted to get some feedback on that, how people felt about it.
Okay, let's get it.
And all right, so how do you feel about it? Because I got a feeling that I kind of disagree with what you're
saying. What I'm gonna say? I was both sides. You know, I was in a situation where I was the abuser. I used to, when I was younger, I did not give a fuck.
I'm coming
through a window fucking this nigga up. We on 52nd Street fucking this nigga up. Where he at? Let him not answer his phone. I put a GPS on his phone, tracking device, before all this shit came down. But it wasn't never accurate. So he could be at 5622. But it's picking up 5613. So I'm like, which one of these houses he at? Like, I used to be drawn. Like, I'll see him bust him upside his head. What you say? Bang. I told you to do this. Like, I did a lot of drawing stuff. So now that I'm older, it actually, you know what happened? Somebody recorded me. So I had on some tights, barefooted, and a sports bra running down the street after him.
Looking crazy.
Yeah.
Looking crazy. They was like, this is when they called me Gutter. They was like, Gutter, I should put you on YouTube. Look at this. I'm on a corner. Excuse me. I got steamed up. All you see is me running to him. Boof, I bang like this or whatever. And I uppercut him. Bam. Like, they was like, yo, she in there fighting you like she a whole nigga.
Yeah.
I'm like, yo, you gotta smack that bitch. Yeah. On camera. And I was like, oh, that's
you had to see yourself. Look. You had to see yourself.
Like, wait a minute. I said, yeah, I don't want to be like that. Like, I'm caught up in my feelings right now. Like, I didn't like that. And then I realized he caught all that negative energy. I started dating him after I lost my daughter. I never grieved that loss.
Okay, you see what I'm saying? Right.
So me being hurt, if I think about her, you closest to me, I'm hurting you. I'm hurting to you. Like, you get the fuck on my... Like, go ahead. Like, da-da, but it's not for you. Yeah. This energy I feel isn't for you. Like, you know what? So I had to let him go. I let him go, and I gotta deal with this.
Yeah, because that don't make it right.
Right. It was bad. My mom, to the point we going to the hospital. He cut all up and shit. And the doctor, like, who did it? He said, I punched the glass. And the doctor just looked at me. This bitch gave me this grin. I was like, damn, bitch, what you want to suck his dick? Like, she gave me that look like, bitch, I know you're doing something. Because it was to the point we had to switch hospitals we was going to. And I was like, yo, I'm really fucking this nigga up.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Like, real shit. And
that's where I was going to come in. Because I know there's a lot of females that have been either in domestic violence relationships or was raised in a house where it was a lot of domestic violence. They are addicted to the drama.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, if they get coming to a guy that's cool, calm, collective, it's like they don't respect this nigga.
Whatever, they being the abuser. There you go. That's all they know.
Right.
So it don't matter. Go ahead. I'm not going to put you on.
No, yeah.
Whether they're the victim or whether they're the abuser. When you grew up in homes wherever you see your parents getting abused, or mm-hmm. wherever you're the one getting abused.
Right.
You wind up growing up either being the abuser or coming across right. a person that's whooping your ass, and you think that is okay.
Or right. even okay. if, like yeah. she said, it's when she okay. was grieving, sometimes they come out of one relationship, they go into the next relationship without that. Taking that time, right. and that one was
hurt
toxic.
People hurt people.
Right. So that one was toxic. So now you addicted to the toxicity. You right. you love the drama. You understand right. what I'm saying? Like right. I've seen that happen like so many times where I'm like, but bruh, it's not really him, it's you. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Bruh, and then, like, listen, it really was. Like, seriously, I wasn't sleeping. I was up. Every time I would try to go to sleep, I'm having flashbacks of my daughter. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that right. shit was like, couldn't nobody tell me how to deal with that shit. I'm staying up for days at a time. That's when I got my mixtape done in like 2 fucking weeks.
Oh, wow.
I'm in the studio all the time.
You up?
Life was going good. Like, I tell people all the time, life was going good. It was looking good for me. But all of, you know, what comes with it or whatever. Everything right. was looking good. But what people didn't realize, when I went home to an empty nursery. I'm with my daughter. Right. You know, that was something else. I was like, oh, girl, you killed that show. Thank you. Right. So it was like, I'm missing something. So I really had to take time off. I think I took a whole year off after that. Right. But that's how that was. So, but he called all that shit.
Yeah, what's some of the solution? Because I think it's a couple things. Like,
you got to fix...
One thing, a two-parent household makes a big difference. Now, it could be abuse going on in that. It could be abuse going mm-hmm. on in that. But I have noticed that people... I have a two-parent household. I have mm-hmm. a wife. My mm-hmm. family structure is so different. My son get into all kind of shit. But he has never seen mm-hmm. us actively disrespecting each other actively. So I foresee him treating women a lot better than the most. Normal than most, right? Right? So we got that. Then learning how to co-parent healthy, mm-hmm. because sometimes even if it's not a two-parent household, people still can't co-parent.
John still can't co-parent to this motherfucking day. All
right. But it's no balance without two people.
I come from a good upbringing, right?
Right.
I had both my parents, mother, father, but I feel like the way that I was handled or chastised, I feel like that's abuse. You see what I'm saying? No mm-hmm. child, at the end of the day, is a certain way or a certain way that you go about chastising a child, period. All the way around the board. Now, if you just got a hard-headed child and that child is just hard-headed, there's other ways and solutions that you can find or come about than just be.
You don't think you don't think it depends on the child's personality? Because some children can take it, some can't. So everybody's emotional tolerance, pain tolerance is different.
Mm-hmm. Right, but see, that's where the detrimental come into the child, because a parent think that they only know what's best to do, and that's the best way that they know how to chastise their child, so that's the only route that they know. So you chastising your child, okay, I feel like the way that you whooping on my ass is you doing it too much, and you're, you know, it's becoming a habit. If right. I'm in a certain way, I've been this way at a certain age, I'm this age, and you're still whooping my ass. So, okay, if I feel like I was abused, the family, whether it's my father or my mother, may not feel like they was abused.
Right, right.
Because they feel like they was chastising their bad-ass child.
Absolutely.
You see what I'm saying? Right. But meanwhile, they don't understand that every time that I left outside their house, I got in trouble in school. I was always fighting. Right. I was always just doing the most because I wasn't going to fight my parent.
Right.
I wasn't going to fight my parents.
Right.
So I will act out on others and attack others. And I was this high.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? So I was acting out in other areas where I was, you know, being angry. And it's like, I don't know. It's just like, I don't know. You become that made me, when I'm in a relationship, the first thing I know how to do is when I get mad is punch on shit.
Mm-hmm.
That's not cool.
Right.
That's not love.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? A lot of that go back to, if I felt like I was abused or I felt like I was getting my ass whooped for anything, I shouldn't want to do and be a certain type of way to other motherfuckers if I know that shit was done to me. I know what it feel like to be done to me. I know what it feel like they can't do nothing. You see what I'm saying? To the people, right, the person that they're doing it to.
Right. So I want to make you the opposite end of that. So I had a one parent house. I had my grandma who was like my mom, but I had my mom who was like my mom too, but not really. She was like my sister, right? So me and my mom, by the time I was 13, we caught 3 cases together by then. We was co-defendants 3 times. This was my road dog, my rider, my everything. I got in the central, still wasn't going to school, no punishment, no nothing. I took that without the discipline, you know what I'm saying? I got into a situation where I was constantly getting in trouble, which led to how it led to, which is how I know you. We all know the story. But the bottom line is, if I would have got my ass whooped a couple times, that could have changed the course of my life.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? But I didn't.
Right.
I had this, so I didn't. So because I didn't, that caused me to be able to just make the right or wrong decision on my own without any repercussion.
Right.
So it has to be some type of balance. And mm-hmm. I think it depends on the child.
Communication, I feel like, I have a 17-year-old child, right? Birth, right? My child is transsexual, born male, now female, right?
Shug. Hey, Shug.
Shout out to Shug, Team Shug. But I feel like the things that it is that I retrieved growing up, I don't handle my child like that. At any level, my child could get on grounds level and tell me or feel, if he feels a certain, if she feels a certain type of way, she could tell me. You see what I'm saying? It's about making your child comfortable, not being a friend, but just being comfortable so that the things that they endure in life, and yes, we do make life hard. We do, I mean, not life hard. We do make life two ways. Either we make it easy or we make it hard. Mm-hmm. Some go about it the hard way. Some go about it the easy way.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? And that's just the things that it is that I experience. I just don't. The first thing, if my child do anything that I feel like she needs to be chastised about, I don't just pick up a belt and I don't punch or hit. I talk.
Right.
I talk. Why? What's the reason of beating when that didn't get me nowhere? I still touched state penitentiary. I was in and out of placements, in and out of the county. I still did all the shit that she didn't want me to do.
Right.
I still did it.
So,
but she never.
So you don't think that there's a? I think there's a certain age limit to beating. So my son about to be 14 in 3 weeks. Uh-huh. It's no sense at 14. He's 5'11". He's, you know what I'm saying? I gotta really, when I wanna, I gotta pick up a chair on this nigga if I'm going. You know what I'm saying? So right. At this point, it's no point. He's old enough now where either I'm gonna talk to him or I'm gonna get a grown man to see. One time he did some old out of pocket shit, thieving and shit, stealing and shit. I went, put the gloves on him, had my man put the gloves on. They got in the ring, productive. Uh-huh. And then afterwards, for a minute, after they sparred for a minute, they sat down with him. They talked to him for like an hour. This ain't what you want to do, being a man, da-da-da-da-da. So I'm at the point now, he at the age where it's too old to be beaten. You know what I'm saying? But at that age when you're 2 to maybe 7, 8, I feel like that's when you, it's like training a puppy or something. You know what I'm saying?
They're human.
You at that age where you got to get a little spanking, stuff like that. But then when you get to a certain age, I think it's time to cut it out. But that's not the only thing that leads to somebody ending up being violent or being in an abusive relationship. No. You got people that's pre-K, pastors' kids and all that. Mm-hmm. They get out on the thrill. They love the rush. They love that shit. Right, you understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So it's like you can shelter and give somebody so much love and, I'm going to put them, they involved in the church. They this, they that. They never seen no violence. They never seen no street shit in their life. And when they get exposed from being so sheltered, they turn out.
Right.
So it's like,
Either way,
either way, because you don't know how the kid is going to react. You don't know how the kid is going to grow.
Them kids going to be kids, man. And it ain't going to be no ass whoopings. It ain't going to be no nothing. It ain't going to be nothing if that, especially like kids, you know, at a certain age, especially if you're involved with your child, how your child going to probably wind up turning out like this is going to be a problem child. This is going to be a good child. This is going to be a child like I said, you know your kids.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? And in the midst of that being, like, see it, like, I just feel like, I don't know, like, you know at a certain point what type of child you gonna have.
That's
true. What I'm saying? And I just felt like that's how I always knew how to handle my child. You see what I'm saying? That's why when Chug came out, I wasn't surprised. You know what I mean? I was just so mind-boggled at the age that you came out. It was like, oh, the fuck? What you mean?
Kinda
like, you see what I'm saying?
You can't say that, though, because when you was young,
at that age, I knew. It was just, I was scared to come out. I gave a fuck about what adults thought. I gave a fuck about what my mom thought. I'm not, man, I'm a sneak and do this shit. Like, you see what I'm saying? But, like, it was like, no, it was just like nowadays. The generation
is very different.
You know what's so crazy is, like, for one, there's so many different ways to look at certain scenarios.
Mm-hmm.
Like, with me, I'm about to be 44.
Next month,
the 15th of the month. You know what I'm saying? So the time that I came up and was the time to where as though we got our ass beat with anything they can find.
Period.
You feel what I'm saying? And that wasn't just my generation. Like, that came from the generation before me. I just still was able to catch that.
Right.
I was still able to catch that if somebody, you know, one of your neighbors, the lady down the street, catch you doing something crazy or whatever, she going to check you. Somebody going to grip you up and bring you home, and nobody feel no type of way. Nobody's going to want to fight this person for like, oh, you put your hands on my child. You know what I'm saying? It was just a totally different generation that I came from. And it actually made a lot of people, like, when I say, like, it made men. And it made women, because it made you act in a certain way to where, like, you know, you just couldn't do anything anywhere you wanted to do it. Right. You know what I'm saying? You knew it was always eyes on you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You knew it wasn't just your mom catching you or your pop catch you. Anybody catch you is a rat for you. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So with that, it made you more, you know, aware of what was going on. You wasn't doing a bunch of crazy stuff. Now, even with the discipline and stuff like that, like, I was in and out of jail. And with me being in and out of jail young, mm-hmm. I was still getting in trouble. Like, my first time getting locked up, when I got home, I got my ass beat.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it was like, okay, I was young as shit. I was 14. You know what I'm saying? Like, so when that happened, it was like, yo, like, I'm 14. I'm still, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But I still needed that, because everything that you do, you still have to think about what's the other consequences of your actions.
Right.
You feel what I'm saying? Like, and I tell everybody, like, even like with a relationship, you know, with your job, even in religion, like, first of all, you have to have fear. You have to have fear and respect, or you either have to have one of them. You can't have neither one of them. You know what I'm saying? And sometimes the fear is what keep you in check. Because when I was younger and, you know, I was getting hit and stuff like that, I remember one time my pop hit me and I, like, spazzed out on him. You know, but then I had to talk with my uncle and he made me look at it, you know, a little different. Because he actually sat down and explained it to me. So I had somebody to talk to about what happened. You know, and that was another thing, too, because, like, even though we mad, we still have people to talk to. Like, a lot of times now, you know, people don't have nobody to talk to. They have nobody to vent to. They have nobody to tell them, well, you know, you did such and such. Like, even females, and I say this all the time, like, females is, like, the worst with it, with the females that they have around them. Because they could be in a relationship and do some fucked up shit, and their girlfriends are cheering on. Instead of saying, girl, you better go to hell. Look, you better go home.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
When they say they want to go do some shit, you know what I'm saying? Go ahead, I got you. He called me, I got you. You know what I'm saying? They're going to cheer it on. But they don't have that voice of reason, you know what I'm saying, telling them to go to fuck home, you know what I'm saying, to do, you know? So,
I think the lack of, like, communication for this generation.
Yeah, this generation is crazy.
Because they have, everything is through the phone, everything is through the computer, everything is.
Yeah, everything.
Like, remember when we used to
sit on the phone all night long, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, talk for hours. Like, now I send a text and I'm cool, I'm done. You hang up first and all that shit, you know what I'm saying? Like,
or, like, when we used to get on the bus, say you coming from the mall, say everybody went to go see the same movie, mm-hmm. and we all on the bus. We all don't know each other, but we just seen the movie, so we all talking about the
shit on
the bus.
Right.
When you get on the bus now, everybody head down, nobody talking. So people don't know even what it's like to have a social.
You say something to him, it go wrong.
The party.
Nobody can't never get through the house line and shit like that.
Definitely was on the party line. What was your name? I know you remember, nigga. Don't do that.
That's crazy,
not. Me, TT, and Each. What the fuck was
my name? Was Michelle.
We had a corny ass name. Our names was, when we swore them names was decent.
you wasn't in the homewrecking squad.
No, this is some old shit. No, I ain't come out till I was like, I'm until like 2004 I came out, 16.
Yeah, I was in the home record squad.
Yeah, I was
home record cannon. You mean
It was like a three and a bunch name.
Like,
that shit was
dumb as
shit.
Mickey, you used to be
in the
party line? You fraud.
Lola.
Lola. Oh, yeah.
Tell
them
about
Lola. Yes, the party line used to be lit.
But that's when I came back.
It was the Rainbow Rocker.
The Rainbow Room. I was on there before.
MySpace. I come home, this shit. I ain't even an active member on MySpace. I didn't even get to enjoy
this.
I missed that whole shit. I was in jail one time. I never even seen MySpace. I was locked up. I came home to MySpace.
Yeah, I came home to MySpace.
No, I missed the
when I was locked up. It was you know, when you was trying to get on the internet and all that, you had to get the disc, put it in the computer, that AOL disc. You know what I'm saying? You know, so when I came home, like all the young boys, like, yeah, you got to get MySpace. I'm like, what the fuck is MySpace?
I missed that whole way.
Shakita said home record number one. I think Candy was a part of Home Record Squad.
So what is that? Let the people know what that. Let the people know what that is.
Home Record.
Yeah, let the people know what the Home Record.
It was just some party line. It was just some party line shit.
Where people have like a gang, or you would have people like it'll be three. Like it was me, Ish, and TT, and we had like this. We would I forget what it was. It was like the three. We had this dumbass name. It was dumb as shit, but.
But the home records used to, like, whoever we knew was, like, in a public relationship. Like, if say I knew Springwater was with somebody else.
Ocean.
Oh, right. Ocean. Say Springwater and Ocean together. The home record job was to fuck Springwater. You know what I'm saying? One of the home records had to fuck Springwater and then come on the joint like, yeah, I fuck Springwater. Yeah, I know, you know. Nobody knew each other. We were just on some fuck shit. It was weird, but it was fun.
That's just like when you stumble back to like something like the touch base, something that you see it that like it stood out a little bit. It was not a little bit, but a whole lot. Like when you see it, like you never know what the kids is going through. Like, you know what I mean? If you never really,
some of them kids, they killing themselves.
Yeah, there's a lot of children out here that's suicidal. There's a lot of children out here that's self-harming themselves.
But y'all don't think we had the same issues before? The only difference is social media?
Yeah. I think the social media elevated it.
We wasn't doing that. We was just dealing with it.
Me and Shug only 15 years apart, so I'm really old enough, I could be Shug's sister. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I grew up with my child. So it's like, back then, our parents wasn't 15 years older than us. Our parents was 20, 25, and 30. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? Now, okay, I'll be 32 in April. So back to my generation, you had kids having kids, growing up with their kids. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? So the generation of parents.
That was every generation, though. It was just the time that you was actually born into. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Because my parents was young, because that's the time that I was born into.
Like, my mom young, but my mom is 20 years older than me. You see what I'm saying?
See, the thing is...
Yeah, our grandparents, like, we really had grandparents, though. Like, our grandparents... they wasn't 22 and shit like
the
that.
Thing with the time is like this. I put it like this. When I got booked in 2005, and I came home in 2011, that six-year space was the most grown... I went from Nokia to iPhone.
Right.
So it went from none of that shit in 2005. Right. No MySpace, no none of that shit.
You didn't have a chirp. Your
chirp? Yeah, we had chirp. We had chirp.
We didn't have no... So
the time, like, so much growth happened. And once the millennium hit, once 2000 hit, mm-hmm. 1 year was like... 5 years in technology, and then, you know what I'm saying? So the time, even though it was the same amount of time, like he's saying, like my mom was still just as young as Wunk was when she had, my mom was that age, but the space and time, things was changing so fast. Mm. So now, you know, 5 years is a, they call that like, they be like, oh, that's a classic, a song that's 5 years old. What, nigga, that shit just can't, ain't that old? Like, you know what I'm saying?
Right. But it's like, all right, I understand what y'all, what both of y'all saying, but what I was getting at was that at my mom age, I wasn't comfortable with getting on grounds level, whatever event to my mom or my parents, how I feel or how they made me feel. And where I was getting at, it was just like, just have a rapport, have that type of relationship with your child, because you never know what your child was really going through. Like, you know what I mean? And that just stems to just making your child comfortable with, you know what I mean? You just never know what they're going through. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And it's just like...
But what happens when you try everything? Because sometimes there's no trying. I'm telling you, my son, man, so, I tried.
Sometimes.
Me and my
Can I speak with that?
You got to think BL. About it. Should be 17. You think I'm not going through the riffraff? Absolutely. But at the end of the day, it's like, when your child be a certain age and they just a problem child.
Mm-hmm. And been from the beginning.
Certain while, you're tired. So right. The sleep that I lost and the crying and the stressing I once did when you was of age, I mean, when you was above, wasn't above age,
right.
I don't do that no more. I sleep at night. I pray.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? I pray and just make sure that when you get tired of doing whatever you think is out here, it'll be open. You see what I'm saying? I don't stress out no more. I don't mm-hmm. sleep no more. So again, you get tired.
Mm-hmm.
You get tired. Well, tired is not enough. Again, in less than 24 months, my child will be 18 years old. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't do the most. I don't stress out. When you be grown, you be grown. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I'm saying. Once kids get a certain age, you know what type of child you're going to have. And that's how you go about handling.
Yeah.
So, like you said, when you get tired, you're going to know when you get tired. Because the things that you once stressed about, you ain't going to stress about no more.
Right.
You're going to lay your head peacefully at night.
Right.
Pray. I just pray that you
open. Yeah, I instilled it in you. Hopefully one day it come out. If I'm instilling it in you, you know what I'm saying?
Like,
that's just the same. My grandma instilled so much into me. I should be a doctor by now.
That's the thing. Like, even when it came to me, like I was saying, when I was young, I did so much. Like, I was really, really, really into the streets.
Mm-hmm.
But I really had structure in my household.
Mm-hmm. That's how I was.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I really, you know what I'm saying? Like, my mom and dad, like, still together to this day. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? Like, you know, so, and I was getting in trouble, and I had a role model. Like, my pop was a role model. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, when he was younger, like, cold gangster.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I done heard all types of stories about him.
So, can I ask you as a man what makes, because I always ask my son, like, I feel like he don't love himself, because it's like, you got everything. You got your own bathroom, your own shower, your own, like, he got anything he could possibly want, but it seems like he wants to be a street nigga. Like,
right.
You're not forced. You know what I'm saying? Like, I started selling crack at 11 with my mom. I was born and bred into that shit. I ain't had no choice. I'm giving you every option to not be that, and it's like you still want to be that. So as a man, I'm asking you, why? Because I understand when it's not a necessity. I don't understand when
it's not about. Go ahead.
Somebody said, get their ass locked up or go to therapy. That's both helped me and my son relationship.
We doing all that. We in therapy. He done been
all
in
place.
Oh, we all that. Right. Yeah, all
now,
that.
The thing about it is like, no matter what you give somebody, especially a child, is never enough, because they always feel as though, all right, well, it's just like, all right, let's say curfew.
Uh-huh.
When you get on one curfew, they'll push it.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you might say, yo, be in here 7 o'clock. They'll try to 7:30 just to see.
And that's understandable.
You know? No, I'm not saying. It goes all into with being a child. You know, you want to keep pushing as far as you can push. You know, it's like with my kids, I don't care what it is and what you give them and stuff like that. They're always going to want more. You get a belt. Your belt is hundreds of dollars. Okay, I got this. You know what I'm saying? Well, let me try to get these boots. Like, they file. Let me try to get these joints. You know what I'm saying? It's like, it's never enough. So you just keep going. It's not with a boy or a girl or whatever. It just has something to do with being a child and how you push. And it's like, even with me, like, I was cool in my crib, but it wasn't enough.
Right.
Like, my parents felt it was enough, but I felt it wasn't enough. You know what I'm saying? So I hit the block. You know what I'm saying? Like, and it was crazy.
I just can't relate. I don't get it.
It's just,
I guess, because I was forced in. So I'm just like, if I had the life of a kid that had everything, I would have never done that stuff.
Right,
you understand what I'm saying?
Right, that's what I'm saying. That'd be the thing. Like, when you thinking you doing everything that you need for somebody, sometimes you have to see what it is that child really wanted, or that person. You know, like, people get in relationships and shit like that, and you know, and they study trying to check and see if the person cheating. You cheating. Yeah, let me see your phone. But they never sit back and say, like, damn, you good? Are you happy? Like, what's, you feel what I'm saying? Like, you check for, the wrong things, you know? And so you thinking that you doing what you supposed to do, but it could be something else that person want or that person need. You feel what I'm saying? So, like I said, a lot of times, like I said, with this generation, it's crazy because a lot of people really have nobody to talk to. And when you're thinking you're reaching that person, maybe you are not reaching that person. Maybe somebody else need to reach that person.
Right.
Like, my pop couldn't reach me.
Right.
Like, my uncle could reach me, though. That was who they called. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, you know, okay. Because they knew I wanted to leave with him. I wanted to stay over the crib. You know what I'm saying? Like, he was the one since I was a little kid. Like, he used to always come and get me. And, you know, like, I watched him graduate high school, get his first car, like, everything. Like, I was around for everything, and I was a part of it. You know, and they knew that was considered, it was my uncle, but that was my homie. So they knew that's who I wanted to be with. They know that's who I listen to. They know if he talked to me, that's who I'm going to listen to. Right. So that was the person that can get through with me. Sometimes you got to find out who can get through to your child.
Right.
You know, because, like, instead of them sometimes, like, all right, well, I'm going to do this to you. Like, no, I know what I'm going to do. Call my uncle, you know what I'm saying? Like, and then he like, all right, well, fall back this week. Now I'm mad. I don't want that to happen again. Right. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to rock out with him. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm a little kid. He got a car.
Right.
He take me everywhere. That's what I'm trying to do. You know what I'm saying? So when he tell me, yo, he mad or he disappointed, now I feel some type of way because that's the person I disappointed.
Right.
You know, and it wasn't. Yeah, that's the person I look up to. And it had nothing. It was nothing negative against my parents. It was just that you always have somebody, you know, that you look to more than somebody else.
Yeah.
You know, and some people get mad. You know what I'm saying? But it's no need to get mad. It's just life. Like, some people, you know, I know somebody that'll sit back and say, well, you turn to other people instead of talking to me. Well, maybe you don't know how to address certain situations, right, so probably, I can't talk to you.
Yeah, like, I have a, like, everybody, my son.
Yeah, people connect different.
Like, I'll tell him, I could take everything from him. I could take, he don't care about nothing. No, nothing material. So, if I take his game, if I take the shoes I just bought him, like, he don't give up about none of that. But if I say to him, I don't fuck with you. I don't fuck with you, bro. I'm dumb. It hurt him so bad. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just like,
but that's where your connect is at. Like, one of my daughters, she, like, I never touched her. Like, I never put my hands on my daughters. You know, so this one day I get a call and, you know, her mother was telling me about all this stuff she doing. She bad, she doing this, she doing that. You know, so I get her on the phone. I was like, so you fucking up in school? So she coming up with all these excuses. I cut that shit short. Like, yo, like, I'm disappointed. And she just started crying. You know what I'm saying? Like, out of all this shit, like, I didn't have to put my hands on her, but just with her knowing I was disappointed was enough to break her down.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So right after that is when I had to talk with her. I didn't let it go without having to talk with her after that, because now she had to understand why I'm disappointed.
Right.
And what I actually expect out of her as a child.
Right.
You know, so I had that talk with her right after that. She straightened right up. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes it's just to talk who you know, how you address certain situations. You know, it's crazy, but people just don't think about how to play a scenario out. Mm-hmm.
You know? See, some things, like, Chug, I've been dealing with this with my son since he was 4 years old. Mm-hmm. How old is he? He's 14. Now he'll be 14 in a month, in like 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So he's always had issues. You understand what I'm saying?
What type of issues?
I guess you would call them emotional. Would you call them emotional issues? They come off like behavioral, but it's not. It's not really behavioral. It's like something else. And
is it like a mood disorder?
Kind of like reactive mood attachment. He does have mood swing. Uh-huh. Reactive attachment disorder is what they call it. Yeah. But
it was a word for it. Somebody said on here that she was some boys just
he might be emotionally
detached. Yeah, emotionally detached. They said it was. What you were saying, they said some boys just be needing fathers. That's what's missing in a lot of boys' life.
I agree with that.
Yeah, that's true, but I can't say that because...
Or a father figure. A man, period.
That's true because, like I said, like when it comes to, like I said, that's why I bring up the generational gap. Really? And, like, and where it is. Like, people think...
I think kids... That enforce certain things, you feel me? Like, that will step in where your dad was.
They play the father.
Like, I'm a trans male. Like, I raise my kids. Like, my kids.
I mean, don't get me wrong. Like, don't get me wrong, because we, like, had these conversations, like, before, you know, and I always try to make sure I clear up, like, with what I'm saying. Like, as far as when it comes to when you say two-parent homes, when it comes to two-parent homes, like, if you in the household, you can treat situations different. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can attack stuff right there when it happens. You don't have to wait. You know what I'm saying? Like, the child is going to act a certain way because he know, like with my dad, like, he used to come home from work and sit in his room, but I knew he was there. Mm-hmm. So I'm only going to do but so much because I know I can go but so much before I get his attention. Mm-hmm. And that's the attention I didn't want.
Right.
You feel what I'm saying? Right. So, like I said, certain times, you know, you look at what somebody else can be able to handle, you know, your child and stuff like that. It's true. Like, I know, like, great mothers that is the only parent and the father's not in the child's life, period. And they do any and everything that they can and raise good kids, you know. So it don't necessarily mean that you're going to raise a fucked up child. You know, it just means that a lot of times the mother has to go extra hard, you know, and then the mother has to be, you know.
A lot of kids act out because they looking for attention.
Like, yeah.
They want a certain type of attention that you're not giving them. Like, I feel like Chuck Fowler was in his life his whole life. Mm-hmm. My child came out at 12. That was the last time that my son father did anything for my child that I feel like I was the type of parent that wanted to take him to court. Absolutely not. Was I angry? Absolutely the fuck not. Was I mad? Absolutely not. Me and my son dad have a regular conversation. Do we talk often? No. But do I hate him? Absolutely not. Mm-hmm. However, do I feel like my son yarn for his father? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Rather my son act like or gets on ground level like he don't care.
Yeah. Because that's what they do.
That
yeah.
was involved. Right. You see what I'm saying? It's just who you want to be, you're not putting to the side. You're not settling to accept who your father wants you to dress down and be around him.
Mm-hmm.
So it's either accept me for who I am or you're never going to see me again.
Mm-hmm.
And he's never going to see him again because he's not willing to settle to dress down to make you comfortable.
That's a strong, he's strong though. He's strong.
I just was having a conversation with my niggas in the car.
Mm-hmm.
These niggas said, I ain't raising no faggot.
What?
I turned around, I said, what?
Right.
Bro, I don't give a fuck what you say, bro. I ain't raising no faggot.
Right.
A rant? It's a million other things you can talk about. Right. You talking about you ain't raising no faggot, so I said, damn, why you say that?
Child.
He said, it's different with girls.
Mm-hmm. No.
I said, what you mean?
That shit all the same.
It's different with girls. I said, where are you getting this from? Like, what society taught you this? Like,
right.
Why? He said, they accept it. I said, if they accept it, then
no.
Why they killing them? Why people feel the need? She just said her son can't go around his dad because his dad ain't feeling him because he's a transsexual.
Right.
Right? Ain't that what you said? Right, that's what it is. So,
yeah.
I mean, okay.
Come up, come closer.
You as a man, would you disown your son?
No. The thing is, when it comes to this scenario, is it's nothing new. Like, it's nothing new. Like, men always look like they want to raise a man. You know what I'm saying? Like, when they little boys, from the time that they a little boy coming out, a baby, they got visions. I'm going to do this with my youngin. I'm going to do this with my youngin.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? You want to buy him this. You want to put the fitted on him. You want to, you know what I'm saying, play ball. You got a vision.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that vision is what you looking for. You know what I'm saying? So when that changes, and we already on the tip, like, no, I had a female here, and she had a show, and what she did was she had, like, gay people up, you know what I'm saying, which I had no problem with, you know, and a lot of her topics and stuff was of that nature. I had no problem with it. But I had to make it known to her, it's like, okay, like, I still have a limit.
For sure.
You know what I'm saying? I have a limit because this is my business, for one, and two, as a man, certain stuff I can't tolerate.
Right.
And like and when I explained to her, when she, like, you know, what you mean, she understood, but,
right,
you know, I still had the conversation with her. I was like, now me, I promote parties and, you know, do stuff like that. Now, let's say a party, if I'm doing a party and you have one or two guys in there, you know, dancing, snapping and popping and all that. Now, niggas will look like, all right, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to stay over here, though. You feel what I'm saying? You know? And they just figure, like, okay, they just came with somebody. They came to check it out, whatever. And I'm going to stay in my zone over here. But if they come back and they see that this is what's going on, now it's more. It's four of them. It's five of them. They're never going to come back after that. Yeah, like, it's a wrap for that business. Yeah. Because now that's what this business is going to be labeled as. You know, which becomes a bad thing.
Okay, so is that similar to a white business that's a very classy business with a lot of white people with money, and a couple black people come and spend some money, and the white people are like, oh, okay, okay. But I'm going to go over here. And then two more or three more black people come in, and now these white people are no longer going to come to this place because it's been tarnished by the blacks. So right. Isn't that the same oppression? I feel as though black people have a way of separating themselves in superiority.
No, I understand what you're saying, but like when it comes to life, like, some stuff just happens and you have no control over what happens. You know, like, as far as with customers and stuff like that, you know, you try to set a certain tone. Like, anybody that's in the business, you have a target audience. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. your whole demo, you know who you targeting.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So now if you look at, like, the people that you trying to reach is people with money, mm-hmm. you know, of a certain stature, you know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? Like, and you know, once you got them, it's like, okay, I can't have nobody coming in here with do-rags and, you know what I'm saying, they pants sagging and mm-hmm. stuff like that. I had to put a dress code.
Mm-hmm. But that's just an appearance.
No, nah, but what I'm saying is, you know what it is that you're trying to do because you know what's going to drive your customers in
mm-hmm.
and you know what's going to drive your customers away.
Yes.
You know, so no matter how fucked up it might seem. I'm just saying. Like, no, sometimes when you look at life and you say, that's like even with the double standard, you know what I'm saying? Like, no matter how fucked up we look at it as, it's still life. We can't get around that fact that stuff goes on that we have no control over.
Well, see, this is the thing. I agree with you 100%. I respect the honesty, but there is a control of it that we can have. Because if we decide to just be tolerant of everyone of our people, if we decide on one accord, we're tolerant, regardless, we're black first. Mm-hmm. Regardless if we're gay, straight, trans, whatever, we're black first. We're all on under a certain totem pole in the class of, in this social structure in America. So we black first. So then I feel like black males tend to have a superiority complex to black gay males. They think that they're a little bit better than black gay males. So we start getting into this, then black women is down here somewhere.
Yeah, it definitely is.
I'm saying is, if we can all uplift and say we're all black first, mm-hmm. and that's what matters, and unify in that sense, then we wouldn't have the problem
comes in and with feelings. The problem comes in with emotion. The problem comes in with the way you was raised. The problem comes in with certain stuff that, like I said, like even when I had the conversation with her, is because of the way that I feel. I know a lot of gay men.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I know a lot of artists, especially like with me being in the game so long, a lot of the artists, like the writers and stuff like that, so it's a lot of them
mm-hmm.
that I'm cool with. And I can mm-hmm. sit down and have conversations and mm-hmm. all that. Mm-hmm. But as a man, if you sitting back and you acting like a female more than a female, that fucks with me
right.
as a
mm-hmm.
man.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, chill the fuck out. All that popping and all. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. inside it fucks with me. You right. know what I'm saying? Not because the fact that you're gay. It's the fact that I'm sitting here watching you act like a female more than a female.
Okay, so if that is that person, if that's just how they are, my question always with gay men is, why do people care that person is that person? I don't give a fuck. I'm not fucking this man. Yeah. So why would it bother me that this man acts like a woman? You know what I'm saying?
That's the difference with a female, and that's what I'm saying. That's the difference with a feeling of a female and the feeling of a male, because we feel a different type of way. Like, when it comes to gay males, females deal with them in a different way than a male. Not just black or whatever, like all men.
I think black
is the word
different.
Can I go ahead. Say something? Me working in the jails, all the year I worked in the jails, most of the time
when the man would be all, why he liked that, or why he liking that. They the ones hitting that. They the ones getting.
If they got like an extra. No, that's facts.
Somebody get all emotional like that. Damn, I mean, you want them?
Yeah, if it's too much emotion, but he's coming from just a standpoint of a normal black man.
Yeah.
No, I'm saying this is how they think, and I'm trying to figure out why. Because what we do, we take symptoms that our oppressor has put on us, and we put it on our own people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what we do. So when you say, which is true, it's so true.
Yeah.
If two gay men come in here, all right, we see it, but we over here, and then four come in here, now, like you said, these people never coming back, so you can't risk your business. That's no different than when the oppressor does that to us. Yeah. So I'm trying to figure out a way, what can we do to change? It's the same exact thing.
Right.
So what can we do to change that narrative? Why do black men get so uncomfortable around someone who's just being themselves? Like, that's just their business.
A lot of it. Yeah,
They're not uncomfortable with themselves, but he sounds okay.
So that's why I'm asking him, because he's aware.
All the black men, in general.
Right, yeah. he's aware enough to understand. Right. So I'm trying to figure out what it is at the bottom of this, because at the end of the day,
that's where the hard part comes in. That, because like I said, a lot of it just comes from, you know, I see. So like, you might see a white kid or something like that live in a certain neighborhood, and there's no black people. And then when they see something black, they're like, what the fuck? You feel what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like,
I'm the bitch that come in, I'll be fucking all the white
people. You know, a lot of times, like I said, it just comes from the way you feel about certain situations. But then it's like I said, like, even with the business, and like I said, like, I have no problem with nobody.
I know you don't.
And like I said, even with her, I have to start her own business. She got her own station right now, to where as though that's her target.
Right.
You feel what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I done said that when it comes to me and my business, like, I understand what could happen.
Right, this
and
is, I it, know is who the, it is what it is.
Yeah. It's like, there's no way to get around that. It's like, if I say, like, okay, let's say I take the route that you saying and say, like, yo, it's cool, like, they black, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's niggas, like, I'm not trying to hear that shit, you know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
you know, so when it comes to the reality of the situation, it's like, me as a man and me as a business owner, I can't get around that.
Right, but you also said, as an individual, it makes you uncomfortable inside when a man acts extra feminine.
No, but it don't make me uncomfortable. Yeah.
You said internally it makes you feel
like
wet.
It makes me cringe. It's like, what are you doing? Like, come on.
Right, but have you ever thought about, like, don't you think that if some of these people could change this, they would change
already this? Like I said, I know. Like, no, but that's what I'm saying. Like, that's why I said, don't get me wrong, I know a lot of gay people. Like, everybody with family, have somebody in their family, you know what I'm saying? Like, or you know somebody, your neighbor, and, you know, whatever the case may be. Some people, they kids, and, you know, some people that's very close to them, your uncles, and, you know what I'm saying? Like, everybody had the experience.
Sugar make his
insides tear. No, it's like certain stuff. Like, you ever watch, what's that love? And act up.
Like, he'll do the most shit in there. Like,
no, like, I'll be watching, like, the Love and Hip Hop Miami joint.
Yeah.
You know, you got the boy on there.
Rapper person.
Yeah, the boy, Trina. But I'll be looking like, yo, like, he need to calm the
fuck. Oh, you talking about Bobby Lights?
Yeah. Oh, he's so.
Bobby Lights. I'm talking about the trans rapper, the one that.
Yo, oh, no, he on New York. On New York.
Okay. Okay, yeah, I know you're talking
about New York.
The dark skin boy.
When they keep saying, yeah, because I'm a trans rapper, every 5 seconds, like, nigga, okay.
What the? Sydney Star.
Yeah, Sydney Star. Yeah,
but the thing of been around for a minute.
Oh, tell me.
Yeah, it been around for a minute. Yeah, like, we even had a conversation up here about him. It was funny because when we had the boxer, Yusef up here, that was somebody that he supposed to been messing with and all that, like, and that's it, and that's it, And that's the thing too. That's the thing with me too. Like, I can actually sit back and, as a man, I can sit back and have a conversation and talk about certain stuff without feeling some type of way. Like, I can actually sit back and like,
we can conduct. Yeah, like, some men we can't even have this conversation. Yeah, right. So that's why I'm saying you at a you at a certain level of elevation. Yeah. So that's why I want to know, like, what is it about it? Because, you know, for the gay females, it is a lot different. You know, I never had a problem. Oh, my guys loved me to death. You know what I'm saying?
And, so, that's what I'm saying. When it comes to that, because, like, females, the thing is, when it comes to the feelings, females don't make us cringe. Right. You know what I'm saying? Like,
we look to get real. Y'all be acting like, yeah,
oh, having three. Nah, until they take one of our chicks or some shit like that. You fucking. Yeah, yeah, right.
It's like, well, man, right now, I got somebody who husband hates me. Yeah. Stalking me. Hitting my mans up, calling my mans.
Yeah, I had one of my closest friends, his female was messing with this chick. And it got real. He wanted to fight.
Yeah, like, I like that shit.
He was pulling up. I'm like, yo, you gotta chill. I told him, you gotta chill. I remember one day they had an argument and shit. And I always fuck with him about this argument. And he was out there like really trying to fight. You want to act like a man? I'm like, I said, chill out. I said, because you're going to. I said you're gonna get. But the thing about it is, still as a man, we can't go out and fight that female. Right. You know what I'm saying? We can't put our hands on that female as a man. But you know what I'm saying?
Men out here, listen. Let me tell you this, right? Like this, for example.
That's pride. Like, that's pride.
All right, y'all get into a situation, all right, bang. I'm gonna be the first person that she called, period, because it's like when you with somebody for a certain amount of time, the first person right. you know, yeah. dude, right. it's just, yeah. it's not, it's like, you know, your right. family is priority, but it's like, let me call my, because I know she won't probably get here before.
Right.
You see what
anybody,
I'm saying?
Right.
But she come, people, I come, but when she tell me, she like, won't a nigga hit me, and I'm like, all right, but it's like, bitch, I'm on all my teeth. You calling me, I'm thinking, this is a fucking nigga. But I'm coming. Like, okay, like, bitch, I was in my head. Like, I hope these niggas is not here. Like,
yo, listen, that's why, look. Like, this bitch, look, all the way through middle school, I four boys. Yo, you know, I'm like, a tomboy, so all the way up until eighth grade. By the time we got to ninth grade, them niggas had all these growth spurts. Them niggas was big as shit. I said, guess what? I ain't fighting y'all niggas no more. I got the tray 8. Yeah. I'm going to shoot every last one of y'all niggas.
That's another thing.
That's how we going
to
do it.
Touch back to that. I'm happy that you just said that. Like, a lot of people, like, this probably not abnormal for a lot of people. And I really don't wish jail on nobody. Like, I had a brother that was doing, me and Porter was talking about that. Like, just touch base. We talked all the way down here. Or whatever, and I just was touching base. Like, I got two little brothers, right? Mm-hmm. And the way that this society so is so fucked up in this world that everybody just dying, everybody killing people for unnecessary Thanks. Reasons. You see what I'm saying? And everybody is just dying. You see them today, they not here tomorrow. Right. You see what I'm saying? And I got two brothers. One that had a 25-50, right? His sentence overturned right now. He don't got no sentence in court. I got That's a brother sense. That had 8.5 to 16. He got 3 more years. He come home. But I'm happy as shit my brother's locked up. Like, my brothers is alive. I got brothers, and I got brothers that were street niggas.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? And who knows if they wasn't in jail.
Right.
Like, and that's what made me get through. Like, I did 5 years upstate, right? What made me get so, like, the way I was living out here, I wasn't living the way that I was supposed to. So, right. I probably would have been out here stinking. So, nobody would have left me stinking Facts. Out here. And I felt like I always used to be like, why the fuck do I always get locked up? Why do I always get locked up? Bitch, he's saving you from something. Right. Like, whatever it is that you doing out here, it's not your time. So, bitch, I'm going to sit you down because you're not living right. You're not moving right.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
And that's what that comes down to when we was talking earlier, too, about, like, discipline and stuff like that, because it's a lot of stuff that I went through and I sit back now as a man like, yo, if they didn't do such and such, this would have been going on, or this would have been going. Like, even getting locked up and stuff like that. It's like, now when I move, I move different.
Right.
Because I had a chance to go through that discipline era. You know what I'm saying? Like, with me getting locked up, or, you know, getting in trouble by my parents. So, like, it's certain stuff that are being instilled in you. I remember having conversations. I remember before I took my Shahada, I was locked up a few times.
nobody could talk me into being a Muslim. Mm-hmm. I'm too strong of a man. You know what I'm saying? Like, you, that I'm not being Muslim because I'm locked up. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. like none of that. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, but I had a conversation with somebody that I was actually cool with. He sat down and had a conversation with me, and me and him went back and forth. Now, my whole young life, I went to church, hated it, but I was there. Never paid attention, never was listening, none of that, but I was there. So when me and him started having a conversation, everything that he said, I was throwing shit back at him from church. Didn't even know I had it.
Right.
But it was instilled in me because I was there, and I didn't even know. And I had a whole argument, like, every time he say something, no, in the Bible, will say this and say that. Right. And in my head, I'm like,
where
shit.
Where did
shit
come from?
You know what I'm saying? But it was instilled in me. So, Benazir, that was instilled in me when we had this conversation. I was able to see both sides and then choose for myself which way I was going to go. You know what I'm saying? So, like, it's like, even right now, all the stuff that I went through with me coming up, all the street shit, you know what I'm saying? Like, I done for all types of cases, you feel what I'm saying? Like, and a lot of times when you sit back on your life on the line and they say, like, yo, you facing life and shit like that, and you walk away from it, and then you sit back, like, that might be the very thing to make you say, man, fuck this shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm good. Like, me, I got tired of motherfuckers, like, telling me what to do, and you know, you looking at motherfuckers like, yo, if we was on the street, I'd fuck you up on the street. But in there, they got the authority to say whatever it is that they want to say to you, and you can't do nothing to them. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, or go to the hood. You know what I'm saying? But the thing about it is, it's like, then when I came home, especially the last time when I came home, I started doing shit different. I started moving different because now I'm to the point to where, as though that disciplinary that I had, you know what I'm saying? Like, all the shit that I went through, I'm like, man, fuck that. When motherfuckers say, yo, we out? Nah, I'm chilling. I'm, I know everything on
know.
TV.
Yeah, I know what I want. And I'm going to tell you, like, ever since, it took me probably 10 years to realize, like, how blessed I was. Like, I got in a shootout with the cops. I shot this cop. These niggas shot me back, of course, multiple times. Yeah. Then they dragged me out of the house, stomped on me while I was handcuffed, beat me with the black. I mean, I had boot prints and all that all on me, bullet wounds, all that all on me. And it was all this, like, glass on the ground from them shooting into the windows. And when they dragged me out, all the glass was just, like, going in my skin and shit. And as they stomped me, everything in my pocket, it was like Super Mario. Everything in my pocket was coming out. All the changes. Like, these niggas. Like, and I can't cover my head or nothing. Like, my motherfucking arms is behind my back. I can't even protect my head, protect my neck, nothing.
Yeah.
But it took me, like, 10 years once I started seeing how niggas was really getting, like, these cops is just shooting first, no questions. And they thought I was a teenage boy or a boy at the time.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like they you know, for the sake of me being a female, they didn't. No, they was really out to get me. They was going in me right there. And it took me, like, 10 years after it happened, like, to look at it, like, damn, like, I'm really here for something. It has to be some reason. It's too many niggas that didn't make it out of their situation.
Right.
A lot of niggas didn't do shit. You know what I'm saying? They didn't even have a gun. Right. I shot this nigga, like, with no remorse, no regret. I didn't know he was a cop.
Right.
I got a parole board. I stick to my story. Facts. I did not know that he was a cop at the time, but don't matter. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's like, it took me a long time. I was so defensive about it and so, like, man, fuck them niggas, like, da da da. And then as I kept seeing all these young black boys just get murdered for, like, toy guns or having just for no reason, basically.
Yeah.
I'm like, yo, this shit, I'm really blessed. You know what I'm saying? Like, and it was the 35th. They was known back then to just do wild shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, and that's when I kind of, like, started to look at my life in a whole different perspective. But it took me so long. I didn't come out of it originally like, oh my God, like, I'm blessed. Like, I just came out of it like, fuck it.
Nobody gets it right then. Like, you don't get it. Like, that be the stuff, like, later on, you sit back and when you sit back and start thinking about the stuff that you went through, and then you start thinking about, damn, that could have happened, or if I would have did this, this would have happened. It could have played out a different way. You think about it later. That's why I say, it even comes to the stuff that, when it comes to your parents and stuff like that, you don't appreciate it at first, and until you actually get grown, most of the time, then you sit back and think about the reason why.
Right.
Like,
hard, but it's so important.
Of course,
question.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's hard because you look, no matter what we talk about, when we talk about religion, we talk about race, and, you know, we can even sit back and, like, when it comes to, like, the cops and stuff like that, you know, like, you might have me driving a car with the windows tinted up. I'm going to get pulled over because they automatically feel as though it's a young black nigga in there. He got a gun. Or it's probably five niggas in there with him. You know what I'm saying? Or whatever. Every time they pull the car over with tinted windows, they think they got something. But then now that's played out. They pull you over and roll the window down. It's a female. Now they're like, oh, let me see. You know, they totally different because now it's a female and they had a whole nother agenda when they came to that car because they targeting black males. Females is not the target. So when I tell females, like, you can't tell me how we feel as black men when it comes down to the system. Y'all gonna say we do this, that, and the third. Not me. I work every day. I got four businesses. But that's not gonna stop them from pulling me over and fucking me up.
Right.
For no, thinking not. I'm a street nigga. It's not.
But some
they don't have no.
Yeah, R.I.P. Shonda. Them cops don't give a fuck.
Yeah, they don't go. No.
R.I.P. Shonda.
Yeah. Yeah.
They don't care. They don't care
Now it only happens that, like I said, like when you're being targeted. I'm talking about being targeted. Like we're targeted. You know what I'm saying? Like that's the difference. Like when they
people like them that appear like to look like boys or whatever, they're going, they're getting the same thing.
Right, because they being targeted because they targeting the black male. So if you look like a
that's what I'm saying.
Right.
They feel the same way you feel.
Right, but what I'm saying is when it comes to the a female that she's a female. If I'm having a conversation with a female and we talk about our day to day when it comes to a cat like me, I don't lost count how many times I've been pulled over.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Let's just say I had a car with no tint. I'm going to get pulled over. You know what I'm saying? Because they just want to see.
Right.
Now, that same car, a female can drive for 5 years and never get pulled over unless her tail light is out.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's a different. Like, we're targeted. Now, if they look at it and they think it's a male or whatever the case is, you can't say
it's targeting under
they're
same
still targeting the male. You know what I'm saying? Like, so, of course, so certain people, certain people. You know what I'm saying? Well, I'm talking about like the majority. You know what I'm saying? I'm talking about like at.
They shouldn't, but
not. No, I'm talking about like at the. I'm talking about like at the station. I'm talking about like at the station when they leave out. And they go start their day. When they go to start their day, they have targets. When they leave, I remember I had a car. Yeah, I had a car, and the car that I had, I was cool with. Then one day, a cop friend of mine's. A cop friend of mine hit me up and said, yo, that car is on the list now. Park that motherfucker. Yeah. Because now they targeting, like I said, the car that I had. I was cool with it. They used to ride past me and everything. But once it got put on the list, he already knew, like, they're going to pull you over every chance they get now. You know what I'm saying?
That's why I want all y'all to listen to this.
You know, it's crazy because, like I said, when it comes down to it and we look like, what can we change it? Like, what can we do? Like, who can we talk to? Like, where can we go and rally at? Where can we? Then all that shit that's been seeming hopeless because, first of all, it's not enough people to sit back and try to change something or the right people in position and stuff like that. That's why, like, even when Meek was locked up and everybody was like, free Meek and all that, and people was like, everybody got somebody locked up. They want to be talking about free Meek. You know what I'm saying? I was like, that shit is going to make. No, I was like, but it was after the fact. You know what I'm saying? Because the thing about it is a lot of people just felt some type of way that this is a rapper. You know, especially being from Philly, like, oh, they dick eating and, this, that, and the third. But then when it comes down to it, it's like, did you see what happened?
Yeah.
That happens to a lot of people.
Right.
And but they don't have the popularity or the celebrity to be able to.
Right. And that's what I was trying to
explain. Pull it off.
That's what I was trying to explain to other people.
They freed them.
Right. When they were saying, like, oh, why do we care so much about Meek? Y'all don't care. I was trying to explain to them, no. Meek is the face. We're trying to push a whole different narrative. And, like, this is the career that I'm in, actually. Like,
okay.
This is, you know, I focus on prison reform. I focus on
rallying black people together. That's why I'm trying to break down the social constructs of gender, of sexuality, because we need all to be together. We can't afford to be split up because we're gay, because we're light skinned, because we're none of that shit. We all need to be together.
A lot of times it had to be the person in position, because it's like now, it's like now when it comes to TV and all these reality shows and stuff like that, the people behind it is the people that saying like, all right, we're gonna put this guy here, we're gonna put this guy here, and then you got guys kissing, you got females kissing, but it's the powers that be. So now what we wasn't accustomed to, we now see it every time we turn our TVs on. Uh-huh. You know what I'm saying? So it was like at one part of you can say, damn, it's forced on us. Uh-huh. But then the other part is forcing you to see what's going on beyond what we already know and what we already comfortable with, what we see on a regular basis. Now, if we want to watch this show, this is what we're going to have to watch. Uh-huh. So a lot of times we might have to sit back and now understand it. You know, like, you might be watching a show when somebody's going through something. Like, the perfect thing is, like, you know, somebody that's gay and, you know, we might be a person that's not really into that, but we see them go through a certain thing and say, like, even with the boy from Empire, yeah, like how everybody does, that's like just rally behind him, like, yo, like, that's fucked up, like, he ain't deserve that, right. You know what I'm saying, like, gay, black, like, he didn't deserve, no matter what he is, you know, right, what I'm saying, like, right, that was crazy.
Yeah, and that's what I'm, like, just aside of the gay thing, it's just like, us as black people, yeah, we find different things to segregate or to build our own level of superiority chain. Mm-hmm. Sexuality being one of them.
Yeah.
Gender being another one. Colorism being another one. Whatever we get rid of, we'll replace it with something else. Yeah. If there's no colorism, if there's no gender discrimination, if there's no racism, it'll be weight discrimination. Whatever it is, because that's what we do to make ourselves feel. Everybody wants to feel like they're above someone because that is the social construct that we're in America.
And the social media elevated everything that goes on. It's just like even with the police shootings and, you know, everything that is going on has been going on.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, people getting fucked up by cops. They've been getting fucked up for years and years and years. But it's just like now, oh, shit, you about to fuck him up. You right. Feel what I'm saying? Like, everybody that's fighting.
Or you ever see a man beating the shit out of a female aware. And all these niggas are standing around recording. But and they not even doing shit. Right. And like, a nigga could be beating the shit out of a bitch and like, they just watching it through. That shit is crazy.
Like, yeah, but a lot of the scenarios that play out, like, on social media is, like, when it comes to, like, social media, it's a gift and a curse. You know what I'm saying?
You took that right out my
mind. Yeah, it's a gift and a curse because you might have somebody, like, you might have somebody that is sitting back and recording and not doing nothing, but now, once it hit social media, you got people like, yo, that's fucked up. They reposted, then got reposted 50 million times. Right. Now you can actually do something about that situation. Yeah. Like when that cop was fucking that girl up recently, mm-hmm, and slammed that
north.
Young
girl.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? If it wasn't for somebody recording that situation and posting it, you know, like, it wouldn't have been no investigation. You know what I'm saying? So
there was also a time where if a man was beating the shit out of a female like that, you had stand up niggas that would, even if they didn't fight the nigga, they would just grab the nigga like, yo, bro, chill, like, yeah, and just like kind of hug, bear hugging, chill, like, whatever. Yeah. Now, like, nobody does nothing. Everything is for views. The person that's recording, their MO may not be, oh, let me get this out. They're not thinking all that. They just want views. They just want people. They just want people on their line. They just want people on their feed.
A lot of that be fucked up, and that's why I'm glad. Like, when it comes to certain shit, like, they try to hold people like that accountable for them not taking action. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I understand people don't want to get killed. People don't want
to
get in the middle of shit.
Yeah, people don't try to get in.
You know what I mean?
But you're supposed to. Like, you get locked up for that. You know what I'm saying? Like, you around, something happen, you ain't do nothing, they'll lock you the fuck up. People don't even know it's a law for that.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
They don't.
You'll get locked up. You know what I'm saying? Oh, you was dead. Oh, you recorded it? Turn around. You know what I'm saying? Like, because you could have helped. You could have prevented it.
It's not one killing, like, out of my whole life. It has never been a killing, like, that hit the internet or social media. Like, I'll probably look at it and be like, damn, that's fucked up. Or, like, damn, he didn't deserve that. But that Kenika Jenkins case,
that did something to me, and I watched it from the beginning to the end.
And talking about the girl in the freezer?
Yeah, okay. Y'all said this was going to be a cold case because all social the people media that was involved and then social media, it just was like, yo, that's fucked up that this girl not even going to be able to rest in peace. And like, I salute her mom and everything for everything that it is that she's doing, but it's just like, that's like a never-ending situation because it's too many people that was wrapped in the mix of it.
Yeah, that shit was crazy.
Like, yeah, a lot of it is so fucked up. Like, when they shot that boy that was reaching for his ID or some shit, and you watched him get shot, like, all that shit be fucked up.
You said what, the guy that got shot?
That was in the car, in the passenger seat, reaching for his ID or some shit. Yeah, he was like, his girl was
recording the whole thing and they aired.
Yeah.
What are you talking about, Philando Castile?
That shit was so fucked up.
This is what I don't understand. Like, people, like, they view, like, a lot of people in this world is messed up because they too judgmental. I feel like there's a lot of self that you can self-reflect and you could beat your own self the fuck up about than to, like, really sit there and really focus on or zone out on what somebody, it always, that stems back to what you said. Like, people always, do and be a certain type of way to get the attention up off themselves or make themselves feel better.
Right.
You see what I'm saying by channeling in on other situations? I just feel like it's so much shit that we got within ourselves as humans, like flaws of our own. Some people recognize them, some people stay in denial.
Right.
That we could work on ourselves.
We start
and
within,
like,
we won't never make it to nobody else.
And it's like, damn, where I was going.
I know you was rolling though.
That's what I just said. Yeah, that fucking don't say that kicked in. This nigga losing in the car in the middle. No, but that's real.
It's just, I don't know, man. It's just, at the end of the day, like, it's me. Huh? Oh, yeah, like, just like working on yourself because a lot of people, like, that's another thing, like, why a lot of relationships don't work. Because, like, everybody replaced every y'all happiness on your individual, your mate.
Absolutely.
I don't want to deal with nobody that they got to place their happiness
on your, absolutely.
I might disappoint you.
Right.
I might upset you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So before you break your own heart, I need you to come as whole. Mm-hmm. I need you to work on yourself. I need you to get you together internally so that when you come to me, I'm already going to have myself together because I'm allowing
absolutely
us to continue to even become one.
Mm-hmm.
Let's make this happiness prosper. Like, I don't want each other to be codependent on each other's happiness because we might disappoint, man. That's
absolutely
why a lot of relationships don't work because they take too much of their happiness and place it on a me, and it's not their responsibilities to make you happy.
Right. No, I say the same shit. I be like, when you got a female and they like, want to go where you going and doing what you doing and like, it's cool. Sometimes it's like, yo, like, go the fuck out. Where's your friends?
Right.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Free, yeah, like, where's your friends? Because you thinking like, all right, well, it's cool, but then when you look at it, like, eventually it's not going to be cool.
Right.
You know, because eventually it's like, you're going to get tired.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So I always say, like, yo, find your friends and, like, go the fuck out. Like, you don't have to party. Because I DJ, you don't have to party where I'm at. Like, none of that. Find your own place.
It's the comfortability, but that's what we play it in ourselves, too. Because everything that's where a lot of relationships don't work either. Because we feel like, in the beginning, that shit be beautiful all the way down to the last. You see what I'm saying? And you will go out of your way to gain this person, to get this person, to do all that shit even down to the last. Mm-hmm. And it's like, once we get into the relationship, we get to know each other. We stop doing the things. We get comfortable.
Absolutely.
We stop doing the things that it is that we did to keep each other's attention.
Absolutely.
You see what I'm saying? And we be stuck on the comfortable.
That's not one of the things. That's the main thing.
Yeah, no.
Like, that's the main thing.
Like, within me, with myself, my example, my
Now, communication is a motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? But that's very important. Right, but
I feel like communication plays certain. It's
not the.
I don't trust you. It ain't nothing that you gonna be able to say. To make me believe anything that it is that you say. So trust.
Now, communication is very important, but the thing about it is the one thing that fucks relationships up is like what you said. Like, we'll come into the relationship, you know, not even the relationship, the friendship, the dating and all that. You're trying to do any and everything that you can do to secure this person. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And then everything that you did to get them, you stop doing once you actually, I got them. You know what I'm saying? We going out?
Well,
you can cook. We ain't going out.
Yeah.
that we like, all right, we got the bag, but we stop doing all the motivational shit to get the
bag. That's true, but the thing is, right?
We get comfortable.
If the two parties are steadily growing, right? Because I've been in a relationship for 10 years, over 10 now. I'm married now, but I didn't get married until 10 years in because I wanted to make sure that no matter what, and we done been through everything at this point, so no matter what, I know we good, right? But in that course of that 10 years, me and her have evolved. We have changed into three separate people three separate times. So it gets to the point where when you're changing and you're evolving, are you going to do you like the person that I'm turning into?
Right.
Because what happens is, over time, I start growing. I start changing. When I met my wife and we met each other, we was going to church. We was both Christians. This, that, third. I started getting super woke. I'm like, oh, I don't know about this Bible shit. She like, oh, I don't know about you not knowing about this Bible shit. You understand what I'm saying? So the question is, do you have the tolerance and the patience to change? You don't. I'm not ever making you change your faith or ever making you. But will you accept that where I am spiritually may not be where you are spiritually? Or will you accept that, oh yeah, I used to be this person. I used to do this. Now I don't like doing that. Or yeah, I don't eat fucking pork no more. So can you stop cooking it in the house? And yeah, so like you evolved from 20 to 30 years old. You were a completely different person. So now the person that I'm with now is not the person that I was with 10 years ago. So do we have the tolerance to grow
a lot
together?
Of don't think about that.
Do we have the, or are we going to grow apart? Or and me and my wife, we have grown apart before. We have fallen out of love before. All that shit has happened. But it's a relationship, is a job, it's work. So we acknowledge it. I might say, yo, I'm not happy. I don't like you right now. I don't like straight up. Like I'll say all that shit. And this is why I don't like. I have even told my wife, I want to cheat, and this is why. So I'm letting you know now. Be on alert, bitch. Start going through my phone and all that. Because, see, I don't want to make the mistake. No, because I don't want to cheat on my wife. I don't want to do it. So I'm going to tell you, I'm feeling like cheating. Yeah, tighten up. And she going to say, I hear you. I'm going to look.
Frame like they did Jesus on the
cross. But she'll say something like, okay, I hear you, right? And then in a month or 2 months, I go and look at the things that I talk to her about to see if I saw any change. If I don't, then that's where the resentment, that's where I'm angry. Like, bitch, because I already told you, so now you think this shit a game?
Right.
So now what I need, but if I see a slight change or if I see some improvement, I'm happy. I'm like, she's thoughtful. She knows what I'm saying? She hears me. Like, you feel me? Right. So it's just a matter of.
Sometimes you can dish that out a little bit and it's just still not good enough.
Right.
And if. Those type of people, I just.
Yeah, if I tell you, bitch, I feel like cheating.
No, the one thing about
you don't change it.
The one thing about a relationship, everybody that gets in a relationship is the person that you can tolerate,
right?
Because everybody has something that you can't tolerate,
right?
And you got something that you can't tolerate. So the one that you can deal with the most is the one that you'll end up with, because everybody got some shit that.
A lot of times, the one that you deal with the most and the one you decide to deal with the most, and those the ones you move off that and make a girlfriend. Those usually the ones that, you know, don't work. And I'm 32. I don't got no more time to waste. Like, bitch, listen, we gonna make this. You know what I mean? The next one is just gonna be the one. Like,
yeah, that's hard. That's so hard though.
And then you're married. Like, I salute you. Like, a lot of people think like when you get married that.
That shit get worse.
Yeah, that shit get crazy. I've been married since
because now you can't
that
say
it's crazy.
Now you guys can't say fuck you, bitch. I'm out.
Listen, like, all right, we starting a new. This is new, bitch.
Yeah.
So doing new things, experiencing new things. Like, you see what I'm saying? And it's like, again, a lot of people in their marriage get so comfortable in their marriage that they forget. They forget, like, they think, oh, because we locked, wedded, and married.
Get one. Let me tell you. Let me tell you, Wonk, since I've been married, the shit done got so crazy. All this time before I've been married, when we go through our shit, we have never, ever, ever. We not a break up the makeup. Y'all see, I don't do none of that shit on social media, none of that. We are always together. It don't matter what the fuck is going on, whatever. We never have ever contemplated actually breaking up or not. We just be going through our shit.
Right.
I might need space, she might need space, whatever, but we live together, so it's bust so much space. But, you know, we both try and get money, get our lives.
Right.
Since I've gotten married in August, there's been so many things that have never happened. Like, she made a comment to me one day, like, I just felt like I got treated better as a girlfriend. Like, maybe we should. And I'm like, what? Like, because we have never, ever discussed the status of our relationship and our problems. whatever problems we're having has nothing to do with the status of our relationship. We still together. Just like, you know, so I asked her, like, well, we never brought up that shit now. So now you bringing up the marriage. We never brought it up when we was just in a relationship. So it's like that marriage shit is like a psychological, even though I felt like everything was still the same. I felt like nothing changed.
It's just the title went up on a different.
Yeah, and now with some bullshit when it comes to taxes and all this other shit that I wasn't looking forward to. You know what I'm saying? But now it's like...
But that'd be the thing. Like, if she said, like... If she said, this is how I feel, that was your chance to figure out why.
Well, I did. I asked her. I said, I said, prior to us getting married, we have never discussed the status of our relationship in an argument or when we're beefing. We have never said, oh, well, what we going to break up, or, oh, well, what we going... I said, so why are you bringing up our marriage in the issues that we're having? Like, why where's the correlation? We've never done that. That's never been our thing.
And I feel like...
Yeah, it's some new shit you started. Yeah, like, where the fuck...
All in again.
That was a good job.
Like, in my past tense, like, a lot of people would never really know the situation with me and her, but I posted her. We're not together, but I posted her. I still move. I still does the things that it is that I would do if me and her was in a relationship.
Uh-huh.
However, I think where we went wrong at, like, we was together for 4 years before we took this break. You see what I'm saying? But we still hang. We still chill.
So is that a real break?
No.
That's my bitch.
When I swear to God, I dare you.
Spring break.
Break. That's what it is that we, you know, have agreed to. However, I think where I fucked up at is that we was like this, friends before 2 years before we even became one. I stopped being her friend. I got so comfortable with being in a relationship that the things that it is that I did together, it's like I got lost in that relationship. So I stopped being her friend because we was friends before anything.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? It's just like that stems back to the comfortability part. It's just like, just when we go, if we don't get on ground level and talk about that shit, like, oh, we gonna be back together. We don't get on ground level and talk about that.
Right. But a lot of things that's changed you, though. Yeah, a lot of things that's changed you, and you got to know what the change is.
She keeps saying
she's a good communicator, but it's toxic.
Yeah. Wong got that fly ass mouth too.
Like, yeah,
that shit is.
I don't deal with people that got the type of mouth that I got. I deal with people that's gonna understand me. That's gonna be able to understand. Like, when I get on fire, she gonna know when to put that shit out, or know when to be like, bitch, that's enough. When you're dealing with somebody that's just like you, this female version of you dressing like it, is hard a little bit.
No, that's very hard.
It's because there's only one of us can be dominant.
Right. And it's like, no, bitch, I'm
going to
be.
I'm a man.
Right. But it's understandable, and that's where the communication come in at, because we need to.
But then on every other level, we equal.
No, but you know what is. No, you.
No, for sure. No, listen. I think
that was a good joke. That was a good joke.
When a lot of relationships, they end bad because y'all end bad. Like, I feel like it's a lot of situations that me and her shouldn't be friends right now, but the growth in me and where I'm at right now with them myself, it won't allow me to dislike her or hate her. This is somebody that I was sleeping with for 4 years.
Right.
Every fucking day. So it's like, how can I waste that much energy or build that much energy? She's human.
Right.
She had a past before me. I accepted that. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? Whether it was a good past or a bad past.
Absolutely.
That I ain't nobody to judge. Yeah. However, I give everybody the benefit of the doubt. Everybody human.
But see,
you see what I'm saying?
Wonka, you got pride and ego issues.
So
my wife, if anybody know my wife, Meek, no, Wonka, I think you know who she is, but you don't know her, my wife. But she, anybody that know her will tell you, she a man in my relationship. She is the fucking man. No, I did ask.
No, that'd be the hardest part, because you ever, your child ever, like, do some shit or say some shit, and you just look like, but it's you. Right. You know what I'm saying?
Right,
I would have said the same shit. So it's like, what do you do at that point? Like, you mad because this person is just like you. So it's kind of harder. You think it's easy. Yeah, you think it's easy to deal with that, but it's actually harder to deal with that because you know it's you. You know how you react to certain situations. It's like with me. Like, I'm dominant. So when it comes to my relationships, it is what it is. This is what I say. This is what it is. This is law. So then if you say some shit.
That's what I'm saying.
Well, that's me. You know what I'm saying? But if you say some dominant shit to me, we got a problem.
So it's a problem. Well, it sounds like.
How is anything going to work with that?
Yeah, it sounds like no matter which way you go. Because you're not gonna respect the person that you can walk all over. You're not gonna respect that.
No, not at all.
So now that you got a challenge.
But it's not supposed to be a challenge. That's why people. I don't think it's supposed to be a challenge. Let me tell you.
Girl, he can't say that.
No. No, but that's what I'm saying. The challenge part of it is the worst part of it. You know what I'm saying? And I always say the same thing. Like, I got a homie and she got a girl, and like them two be like, I be like, yo, cause y'all the same.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It don't have nothing to do with y'all both being females and all that. Like, y'all act exactly alike. You know what I'm saying? So now they fighting for a position. I was like, that's what it is.
Right. Y'all position fighting. Of power.
Yeah, it ain't. Fighting for the position. I said the challenge power. Is coming in is who wearing the pants. You know what I'm saying? Right. That's what the challenge is. You know what I'm saying?
I because feel like, why can't both.
I don't even like me. It's not like skirts.
Yeah. No, I feel like, why can't both.
I'll be listen. Wearing the pants is just like, but, a boundary to the shit. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
I don't
betray to
you
be a man. Thing. I don't betray to be that. But I'm who I am. I cannot betray to be anybody else. So I could come off and be like, oh, bitch, you acting like a man, or bitch, you being a man. But then when it comes down, the man responsibilities, it's like, you be like, well, bitch, I'm a girl too. Like, why you keep, you see what I'm saying?
Right.
Going to it like, okay, well, this is a girl to girl. I'm like this.
I'm the aggressor of this relationship. I'm the dominant one.
See, all right. So, but see, all these roles, no. You just be whoever it is that you are.
That's the hardest part of being in a relationship.
So my
wife, but you know what I say? You know what I say? I have controlling interest. Period. I have controlling interest in it. It's like you in a partnership. You say we partners.
Yeah. You got 51%.
Yeah, I got 51%. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to listen. We're going to talk. We're going to have conversation. But this is my shit at the end of the day. Okay, if I don't agree, this is what it is.
Okay, see, I think that you go off of strengths and weaknesses. Like, when it's time to make certain decisions, I make certain decisions. Like, budgets, finances. I'm very good. Not that she's not. It's just I'm very
gifted. That's where your partnership come in.
Yeah, it's just that I'm very gifted and I'm cheap than a motherfucker. So I'm stack this money.
But who has the last word? Somebody has to.
No, it doesn't, because that's what I'm good at. So what I say in that arena goes.
So you have control of interest.
No, in that space.
You don't even know it.
And
look like her life runs the
relationship. Yeah, but she know what it is.
No, but that's just. No, because that's just one space. That's just one space. She has parts in the relationship that she's better at. So if it's something that I know that she's better at, she has control in that space. Because that's where her strength lies. That's not where my strength lies. You know what I'm saying? So the roles can reverse. If a motherfucker, if I don't know how to cook at all, I mean, that's a bad example, but if...
Yeah, but that's where your partnership comes in. That,
but she has majority in, she has no, majority control in that area.
No, it's just like with this business right here. Like with my business, I own it. Like this is mine. Like I own my business. But I have people that run certain shit. Especially all that internet shit and I got somebody that. That's your shit. This is your shit. I don't know nothing about that. So you definitely got that. Mm-hmm. I can't put this shit. That's your department. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So, but at the end of the day, what happens when it comes to the problem? When it comes to a problem, somebody has to be the problem solver. You know what I'm saying? Somebody has to. Somebody
like
asks me. It could be any problem.
Because the problem, whatever the problem is, determines who is the person that's in control. There is a problem with, so I'm saying there's a problem with, okay, I'm trying to give you a good or a better example. Say my wife is very good with the credit.
Okay.
She runs the credit this is just an example. She runs the credit and shit. She trying to get our scores up. We in the 700s. We trying to hit 850, whatever. If a problem arises in the credit area, that's on her. If the problem arises in the finances in the money area, that's on me, because this is where our strengths and our weaknesses go. So at times the power is exchanged. I'm not going to just keep the power, even though I don't know shit about this, just because I'm just the role I'm playing. No, I'm going to adjust to whatever the strengths or weaknesses of the people are. You know what I'm saying? So you can't just have complete control over everything, because you don't know everything. That person might be good at better
No, what I mean is, that's why I said that's where your partnership comes in, that
But you still want that 51.
Yeah, right. That's what I'm saying. Because all right, let's. At the end of the day, that's just
trade off. Sometimes you gotta trade off your 51 and get the 49 if it's an area where
But that's what I'm saying. At the end of the day, when it comes down to like certain things, it's like. That's why I use business, because business is so much like a relationship, because you have to put in as much work in your business as your relationship. Absolutely. You know what I'm saying? So if you got somebody that comes in and say, okay, we're partners, we're 50-50, and then that one partner might be handling one thing, and you bring that person in because they might be the money, or they might be the brains, or, you know what I'm saying, it might be your idea, but you bring them in as a 50-50 partner. You know what I'm saying? Then when shit gets fucked up, neither one of them can say, I have control and interest, so this is what it is. So now you have to go to mediators. Now you have to do all types of stuff, because within them two, they didn't know to say, okay, well, this is my idea. I'm coming. I brung you in. Or, you know.
That's not the same in a relationship.
No, when it comes into a relationship, it's like you have to know who's the head of your household. You know what I'm saying? Because the head of your household, even if you don't want to say. No, but the head of.
Because it's no head, because at the end of the day, it don't matter how we may be trained to be. At the end of the day, that's where it comes to dropping the labels. It's no labels with the girl on girl. At the end of the
But truthfully, there's this, even with man and woman, even with man and woman, if people was not as caught up in, I'm the man, I'm in control, or the woman, oh, I'm just this pillow princess type shit. That's just either way.
That comes from, you know, having what. If anything, a family structure. That's why I say if anything, and that's why I said, but the only problem comes in that when they don't do what they're supposed to do. Right, then you're supposed to do it. Then it seems, then shit gets shaky.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Because you're not doing what you're supposed to do.
Women these days, they are getting fucking money. Like they are getting fucking money.
But you know, even with that, you got to sit back and say, just because the female is getting money, does that make her ahead of him? You feel what I'm saying? You got somebody like, let's say,
but a male was the head of household because they were the person that provided and all that other stuff.
No, that's not the male. That's just what
was the other reason?
Because that's the structure of a household.
I think that's why me and Mel's would probably never work. Because even when I did deal with Mel's, I was the one in the control. Wasn't no man dictating my movement. So it wasn't good for me and a guy. I think me and we never worked, because it's like you're not. Because
your mentality was like as of a guy.
You're not controlling me.
Yeah, the same how he think was it, right.
But then it's like now when I'm with a girl, it's like it's so much different than being with a guy in a relationship with a guy and being in a relationship with a girl, because it's like to a certain extent.
Like me being with a man was easier than actually being with a woman and being with somebody like her. She's more like, because I'm going to run. I was, you know, running the niggas.
How many guys do y'all know? I know so many men that they woman to pay the bills. They woman pay the bills in the house.
Take care of them.
They get up. They might take the kids to work. They might take the wife to work. While to drive around in her car all fucking day, busting imaginary traps.
That's real shit.
Who's the head of that household? Who's the head of that household?
That's probably her house.
Who's the head of that?
That's probably her house. Like, so first of all, like,
I'm just
I'm trying to figure out who's in that household. Because I see it all the time. And
yeah. Like, no, that's definitely. But that's where the problem comes in that when it comes to when you look at the majority of the people. Because when you look, when a female has to do everything in the house and she feels as though she runs shit.
I think that's what makes women cheat. Like, that's why they cheat. Because
they
like they can't get what they're getting inside their relationship. So they step outside their relationship to get whatever it is that they get. But that's where your communication come in. Let me know, bitch, what it is that I'm lacking so I can tighten the fuck up.
I don't got to let you know if you driving me to work every fucking day. 8 hours, nigga. And my feet hurt, nigga. And you late picking me up. You late picking me up, nigga. And it's raining. And you talking about some fucking, I was here. You ain't been out of job the first. No fucking money. I ain't got to tell you that.
That's a problem.
I ain't got to tell you that.
No, that's definitely. That's definitely a problem. You know what I'm saying? All these Jodies.
Niggas still want to be called head of household. How?
Right.
Yeah.
How, nigga?
Yeah.
Listen.
Right. I mean, that's what I'm saying. That's where it comes into play when it comes to like certain shit like that. Because he is not the head of the household. First of all, like when it comes to like shit like that, it gets goofy because of the fact that when it comes to like certain shit, females will always go back to that scenario. They don't go back to the strong structure. Okay. They'll say, "Well, what about?" You know what I'm saying?
I happen in this generation. I happen to see that more than I see the old. That strong structure that you speak of to me is old fashioned now. It's not. I see more of what I'm saying now, and I feel like it's the mother's fault. I feel like moms raise their sons a certain way, and then the son just.
I just said this, and somebody got mad at me because I said something about the way the generation is now. People, you got so many people that's. You know, confused and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? Like, when I say certain stuff, I say certain stuff because of the age that I am.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, even me, like, when I was in the game and running around touring and stuff like that, the whole caliber of men, I don't care what type of man it was, street nigga, businessman, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't care what type of nigga it was. A lot of them is way different than the guys is now.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, shit was different. You know what I'm saying? Like, the way you dress, like, even now with the chains and shit like that, like, I looked at somebody, like, recently, and they had the rock chain on. Mm-hmm. The same chain I got, and it's long as fuck.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? That was what men did. We wore long chains, and, you know what I'm saying? They came down to, it's like, now you got on the joint. I'm like, that's a choker.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, shit changed.
Y'all used to be dressing crazy in them 2000s.
I'm going to tell you.
Y'all niggas looked crazy.
Let me finish. Like, even with that, you look at it now, it's just the same how we look to people like in the 70s and shit like that, and we look like y'all was dressing crazy.
But that was them. Yeah.
You know, but a lot of times you had to take and understand the generations and what went on. It's like now you look like, I watch how guys dance and all that shit, and I be looking like, yo, this is crazy. Like, they really feel as though that this is okay, and now it has become to be okay. It's just not okay to somebody that came from a different generation.
Ever. Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Right. Now, because the thing about it is, like, me, with I look at the reality of situations, and the reality of the situations is you have now so many females that's raising guys.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like I say, don't matter how good of a mother you are, when you look at the reality of the situation is, it's like, if I'm in my house, I'm a little kid, and I'm dancing like my mother,
mm-hmm.
you know what I'm saying? My pop is going to check me.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Nah. Cool the fuck out. Go sit down.
Yeah.
But your mother's going to cheer it on. Go. Oh, look at him. He's cute. That's cute. You know what I'm saying? Like, right. And so you have so many people that was raised by these females that cheered it on, and it was okay with them. That's what it has become.
Right. Now,
and it has became like what the generation is.
Now, I agree with that. But I will say that there is some good that has come with
black men not being so, black men are so, I feel so bad for them because when they walk out of the house, they're just so self-conscious about everything. I be seeing niggas on my timeline like, this nigga creepy every morning. He's saying good morning to me. Like, fuck, why he saying, like, nigga, good morning. Like, what the fuck? Like, or they can't smile, like, too much. If they smile too much, it look kind of like they might be a little gay or, like, it's just so many different things that they carry with them. So I feel good that
we have that.
Like they got an ice grill all fucking day, or they don't feel like they can't say good morning because they look a certain way. Like it's healthy that they can just be normal human beings without this thing of the, like, though the black men, you just gotta walk out and just every day you gotta be miserable as soon as you wake up. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
it's like a social construct, but the thing about it is let's just look at rappers and stuff like that. Let's just look at the rappers. Like, when I was in the game, like, every city we went to, a nigga would say, you know what, I respect y'all, I fuck with y'all, you know what I mean, y'all real niggas, cause they watch the news and like niggas is really shooting niggas and you know what I'm saying, niggas really got niggas, no it is when it comes to men, you know what I'm saying, because they respect you different, you know what I'm saying, when they know you real, you know. So with me doing the Rockefeller shit and the state property shit and all that, like, let's not even say the Rockefellers, let's just say the state property, it was hood,
right?
You know what I'm saying? Like, now niggas get on Instagram, I got a show out, such and such, or I got an album coming out, and they post it on Instagram. We had to go in niggas' hoods. We got something coming out. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is what's going on. We had to go into hoods where niggas don't go in. Hoods that niggas that's going and do their show and haul ass.
Right.
But we had to go and promote. We had Instagram and all that shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, so.
I had to pull up and bought
it. Yeah, we had to pull up. You know what I'm saying? Like, what's up? And, like, really fuck with niggas. You know what I'm saying? Like, so when we go in cities and shit like that and they respect your gangster, you know what I'm saying? Like, you don't have to worry about niggas taking your chains and all that. Like, now, when you looking at, when you rapping and all that, like, oh, them niggas really. Then, like, now you got somebody, the only thing you do is see him on Instagram and, you know, they got the chokers and all that shit on, but he talking gangster. Watch when he come here. You know what I'm saying? I ain't hear nothing about this nigga. What's gangster about this nigga? You know what I'm saying? You know, and the one thing was with niggas being hard, it stopped a lot of niggas from getting tested. You know what I'm saying? They wasn't so easy to test you.
When you appear to be hard looking.
Yeah, that was the streets. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was just something that always went on. Like, from time, like, even with gangsters, period. You know what I'm saying? Like, Mob Boys, like, and all that. Like, you set this, you put this vibe out, you put this image out to where it's like you not to be fucked with. You know what I'm saying? So it's like then.
But when you carrying that energy constantly, all day, all night, all day, all night, it's not always positive to carry that energy all the time.
It's not that it's positive, but like I said, like, you got so many people right now that's getting tested because of the fact, like, when you look at, like, 6ix9ine with him getting locked up, you know what I'm saying? Like, when you're looking at him snitching,
like,
and
that's why there's a lot of people that's not alive right now because they waste too much time worrying about proving a point or appearing to be a certain type of way. It's like, again, you have so much shit that's going on within yourself that you need to work on, that a lot of niggas that still be alive right now, if a lot of niggas ain't hyper.
Yeah. And
it's true. Trying to be. Yeah. Or a lot of niggas wouldn't be doing life or whatever for trying to
prove a point. Right. But you had niggas that fucked their careers up, you know what I'm saying? Like, done lost their life and, you know, all types of stuff. But like I'm saying, like, When you looking at certain situations, and like when you look at one generation to the next, it's just different. Like, one generation, like I said, that generation carried itself the way that it did for one reason. Like, the generation now carry theyself the way that they do because of the fact that you have so many single
mothers
raising these boys. You know what I'm saying?
All right, so can I say this? So one thing, right? I love state property. Mm-hmm. Of course I do. I'm from Philly. Yeah. I'm from that era.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I was a baby teen in the air.
Yeah.
Feeling in the air is the whole reason I shot that cop, nigga. I was paranoid.
Oh, shit.
I listened to that song 1,000 times a day, and that's what the fuck happened. But I say that to say, there is a correlation in how real Beans and them niggas wanted to stay to what, how their career, the state of their career now. There's a correlation to that. There's a correlation to Hov just cleaning up and saying, listen, y'all, if you don't clean up, you know what I'm saying, you can't, because I got somewhere to be. I got somewhere to go. So by holding on to this image and by wanting to stay real and stay true and stay street, you sacrificed, I'm sure, a lot of opportunities that you could have had.
Yeah.
Had you just...
You're definitely right, because I have had these conversations during the time that it was happening. Like, when you sitting there and you making songs, it's been plenty of times, like, fucking Sparks will tell you herself, because he was the main one I used to get on, because he loved the streets.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like... And everything that he was doing was for the streets. Mm-hmm. Like, you putting out records, like, and the streets loving you, but you're not focusing on the females. You don't have no club bangers. Like, you don't, you know what I'm saying? Like, there's certain stuff when you stay true to the streets, is like, that's what they say, that energy that you put into the streets is what you get back.
Mm-hmm.
Because one thing about the streets is not loyal.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So, and when it comes to, like, a Beanie Sigel and, you know, at the height of his career, shooting niggas, you know what I'm saying, and all of that shit. It wasn't that niggas was trying to portray a certain thing. That's just how niggas felt.
I don't think he was fraud.
I'm not saying that was a problem. What I'm saying is that was a whole generation of people. That's why I say, like, even now with the internet, it's a gift and a curse, because it give a chance to a lot of guys, like, even getting deals and, you know, and being able to not have a deal and make money, to constantly put out music. You don't need a distribution company. You can do it yourself. Go online and get your own distribution and all that shit. You don't have to get signed.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So with the social media and the internet and all that, like, it's a gift and a curse, you know. But the gift is, it gave a lot of the young guys now a different look on life, where they don't have to be what other niggas was.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But that was the era that we had. That's all we had.
Yeah, Kanye fucked that era. I mean, when he came through, he beat 50 that week. Remember when he was 50 with that?
Yeah.
And Kanye won. It was over for the gangsters after that.
Nah,
It was pink polo shirts.
Nah, that was.
No, I'm just saying. But Kanye definitely did.
That was
a voice to outside of street niggas. It was like a different type of person.
Not really, because I tell people now, the reason I hate music the way that I do now is because that's all we have. You know, like, you can turn on the radio and it sound like the same song over. Like, this Domingos, that's, is that everything?
No, you just not looking hard enough.
Listen to what I'm saying. When it comes to the radio, everything sounds the same.
Yeah.
Like, before, when you used to listen to radio, you knew everybody's sound.
Yeah,
you knew what the West Coast sound was. You knew what down south. Everybody had their own sound. You knew a nigga from Philly because he sounded like he was from Philly.
Yeah, we was mad.
He sound like the fucking Migos.
Like, Master P was selling like a million records before we even knew, before what niggas say even came out. We didn't know who them niggas was. They was already popping in their region. We was doing whatever we was doing in our region.
But we had it.
But
when
now
all
music
came
is universal. So now the South running it, and since it's universal,
that came from people being followers.
No, it did come from people being followers, but what I'm saying is, if you grew up in Philly in the 90s or 2000s, you didn't have the internet to access to hear what they're doing down south.
You heard
what was happening around you.
Yeah.
So these kids that are growing up, they're in the era where the South is running it, and they have an access to all the mainstream music, but it's not regional no more. We was regional. We could only hear
this is
what was happening around us.
Now, this is what happened to the music. The thing about it is, like I said, when you had all these different sounds, and then you got somebody that... Because when the shit started to change, the labels were still in effect. The labels still ran shit. And then you had shit like Laffy Taffy coming out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying?
That was the beginning of it.
Yeah, like, when the Laffy Taffy dropped, and, like, a couple drove like behind
like me and all that shit.
And radio was going crazy. Yeah. So what happens... So what happens, the label, when you taking them your music and shit, the label was saying, nah, we need one of them.
Yeah, at that time.
But it was a trickle effect, because now everybody is trying to look, how can I pop? That's why I call it microwave music, because most of this shit that come out is hot for a minute, then it's gone.
But the problem was, when they had I think they like me, that was just going to be an era. Had there not been streaming and internet, it would have just been an era. It would have switched. It would have kept going around. Just how it got around.
That was before the internet and all that shit started popping.
Hold on, let me say
that.
So look, every time time. Every region had their era. So
we how old that song is? How old are you?
I'm 30.
And Laffy Taffy, like, she's popping and all that shit. You know what I'm saying? No matter how old you are, you know what?
No, look, hear me out. This is how it happened. Yeah. So everybody had their era. So West Coast, we running shit for a minute. The East Coast, take it back. Then, you know what I mean? Then the South came, right? South was having their era with that Laffy Taffy shit. Cool. But then, in the middle of their era, boom comes the internet. Now that the internet is here, now this is the mainstream of rap because everybody's hearing the same shit at the same time. Now it's not so much of we listening to State Property, they listening to fucking No Limit, they listening to Death Row. Now everything is straight across the board. Now we don't have a region because the internet is just worldwide. It's just
no, you know what they say the music is now? It's a vibe. That's what they said it is now. Like, it's the feeling that you get now. And like I said, like, when them songs started coming out, it made people feel good.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, when you're listening to a song or you're listening to a Death Row song or, you know, like, a lot of these songs, it's like, you listen to Pac, it's like, yo, don't this nigga owe me money? I'm about to go kill this nigga. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying? So, when you had these songs that was coming out, they was making all these songs that made you feel good. You know what I'm saying? And so when it made you feel good, like now you have all these other people that's now listening that wasn't actually into the hardcore rap. Like now your mom like, well, I like that song. You know what I'm saying? And you got all these people that's liking these songs because it made you feel good. So now that song is doing numbers because the label is looking like, hey, maybe this is what you need to be doing. It's just like with Eminem. Like, as much as he was selling, when he put his first album out, he had a single out. It went crazy. When he did his second album, he gave him a regular album, and they said, nah, you need a Slim Shady.
Slim Shady.
Yeah, Slim Shady.
His second album is his best album ever, though.
Yeah, but the thing about it is they wouldn't let him drop without one of them songs.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's typical.
Because at the end of the day, that was the songs that grabbed everybody. It made everybody feel good. Dude, you know what I'm saying?
I hated that "Hi, My Name Is" shit. I ain't start liking Eminem to this. I sit back with this pack of zigzags and this bag.
Yeah, but you
I said, oh, fuck up this white boy.
What happened was they gave the label what the label wanted. They gave the people what the masses wanted. Now for the motherfuckers that was into what you were saying, now we happy.
Right.
You feel what I'm saying? Right, but first you had you had to make the masses happy first because that's where your money was at.
Absolutely.
That's where you're crossing over and all that. That's where it's at. And it came from the feel good songs. It didn't come from the gangster shit.
But we did not like Eminem when he first came. No black person was listening to that. Hi, my name is.
He was mad.
We were not listening to
that.
He
was mad.
Shove that shit down the motherfucker.
Motherfucker was mad at
him. We were not listening to that shit.
He saw right there. He need a check.
Motherfucker was mad at him. Like, what the fuck?
I was mad too until I heard that. I sit back with this bag.
This nigga can rap. And that was the thing about it is like once a certain
and now we can't rap.
Now what's like a certain get into that. Once a certain audience noticed that he can rap, that's when he really started winning because he had a lot of people already. But the people that wasn't fucking with him, once they heard bars, mm-hmm. which the generation that he came in, like. It was still, a lot of that left. Right. It was still a lot of that left. So it was like, at the end of the day, it was like, okay, we heard that. Now we hit, okay, I'm fucking with Bull.
Right.
So now he got the masses. Now he done came into the hood.
He didn't have a hood before.
Right. You know what I'm saying? Like now he had the hood. Right. And now people defending him. Like they was no longer calling him a white boy. They was calling him a rapper.
Yeah, like that nigga can rap. That nigga can rap.
Man. Yeah, like yo, he can fucking rap. Like now you comparing him to other niggas. Right. Or he'll fuck such and such up, right. Bar for bar. You know what I'm saying? Like so you had to respect him. But the thing about it was at the end of the day, you know, he gave the people you know what they want. But that's why I said like now you got people like Soulja Boy. Like, people don't give him, you know, credit for, you know, the things he did. That's why he's so hyped now on trying to get it because he's not getting the credit that.
I give him all the blame.
Yeah, because he's definitely people don't really understand that fact. Like,
but that's what I'm saying. It was the social media. Yeah. He got it ringing off of MySpace. After that, all this shit became one push of a button, and because we happened to be
actually in the, YouTube, he was like one of the first rappers on the YouTube that you can actually see the dance.
Yeah.
But that was one of the things when we said, like, with the music, it had to make you feel good, and that song made people.
I was at McDonald's working, and we was in the lobby doing that dance.
Yeah, that shit.
I hated that shit when it came out.
Dances still do good. You got a song with a dance, you pop. Because a lot of times people don't even dance at parties and shit no more. Everybody's standing around
niggas stand and look at their phones and shit and be snapping shit.
But that's why people be happy when somebody come out with a song with a dance, because a lot of people do want to dance.
Right. Well, you know the good thing about hip hop now is it's like the number one genre in the world. So even though the mainstream sometimes suck, it's so many sub genres that anything that you're into, you can listen. You can find right now. Mm-hmm. If you still in the bars, there's plenty of niggas that got bars out here. If the radio's not playing it, the streaming shit make it that you can listen to whatever the fuck.
But that's why Meek do good, because Meek was able to adapt. Like Meek's still young. You know what I'm saying? But the thing about it is, Meek raps and Meek just make it feel like the shit that they doing. Yeah. He just give it that feel. Yeah, he does
that whole album. But he on a streak, because wins and losses. I don't know which one is better between championships and wins and losses. I love them both the same.
I think championship.
Both them albums both the same. I don't even know.
Championships. Yeah, championships kind of remind me of when Hov did the 444 album. You know what I'm saying? It was like one of them albums that people that was really into rap needed.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
But he was rapping his ass off on. Yeah. He was rapping his ass off on wins and losses too. But he had super different flows. That joint with him and Thugger.
It showed growth.
But he had a lot of samples that, of course, we're gonna love. Of course, we're gonna love the Respect the Game sample, the Jay-Z sample. Of course, we're gonna love the Biggie Was Beef sample. Of course, we're gonna love the Mobb Deep fucking Getaway sample. Like, you see what I'm saying?
But I'm saying that was
kind of like a cheat code in a way. Wins and losses was more so just from the cooking it up from scratch, and that shit was great. So
he just got an award, a Meek Mill award, and he's having his own day, National Association.
Meek popping now.
Yeah, Meek that nigga, man.
Yeah, Meek the new hoe.
I'm so proud of Meek Mill.
Meek the new
hoe. Because every time he go to jail, he come back and he shit on it.
The one thing about Meek is that he's like still a voice of the streets.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
He's like the only nigga that he did 200 the first week. He the only nigga still rapping doing them type of things.
Yeah, he's still rapping, but like I said, like he's still able to adapt and give people that feel that they looking for. That's like, if people don't know how to adapt, that's why I be looking like when people, oh, this a young man, yeah. No, that's why I know what you doing. Like, look at Hov. Hov will put out a song and put the Migos on the hook. You go do the dumb shit. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to do my bars.
Yeah.
But he know what people want. So he was still able to win and still able to adapt because it's like, okay, we know what they're looking for, so still, let's give it to him.
Right.
So he was able to... he gave it to him, but he just said, I'm not going to do the dumb shit. No, call them Eagles, call Future, let them do the dumb shit, and I just do my verses.
Cause it would be a sad day if I ever heard Jay-Z on a fucking record. I'm like, what?
Yeah, I'd be mad as shit.
I'm like,
what the fuck
are
you
talking about?
I'm be fucking, he would never, but I'm just saying, could you imagine? Like, that's where a lot of the OGs go wrong, cause it's a way to adapt with still staying it to your true self. You feel me?
Yeah, you just
gotta learn. You ain't gotta sell all the way the fuck out and just go all the way.
That was the thing, and like I said, when it came to the music, nobody adapted. Everybody just adapted somebody else's shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They wasn't true to themselves.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But, hey, listen, anything y'all wanna.
No, man, it was
good
talk, man. I enjoyed myself.
Yeah, y'all need a show.
Yeah.
It was dope.
We got
fuck out. Talk about it. That gotta be next week.
Yeah, yeah.
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 Like we got them on all grounds level. We talk yeah. about kids. We talk about, you know, we talked to him about he was open minded on both ends.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. That was a very you know what
I
mean?
I like that conversation. Yeah.
Before yeah. I leave, I just want to talk about my business one more time.
Oh yeah.
Queen, because that was Bill Ground.
Go ahead, talk about it. I show you
Queen Cuisine.
I show you. You'll get the invoice later.
Queen Cuisine. I do residential cleaning, commercial, event decor, and catering.
Okay. Hey.
My email, everything is on my Instagram.
I hope they can hear you since you're all the way in the corner.
I know. I don't know why I'm thinking you can hear me.
Yeah, they can hear you, but you sound like you're probably in another room.
Can you hear me now? But this is the queen of clean cuisine. I do residential cleaning, commercial, event decor, and catering. You can follow me on Instagram. My name is Clean Cuisine. All right. Thank you.
And y'all can follow me on IG. I will be in DC March 9th to the 11th.
What day is that?
I don't know. Are you? March 9th to 11th. Our community, our courts. I'll be in DC for a 2-day panel. My IG is BL Sherelle. That's BLSHIRELLE. It's online. So if you go on my page on Facebook or on Instagram, you will find a book about my EP that I wrote called Die Jim Crow. I partook. I wrote a few songs on the EP.
Okay.
And I also performed a few songs on the EP. And I have my second, my debut actually, project coming out aside from mixtapes. I'm trying to get it out in April called Restricted Movement 2. Okay. So that joint is super duper 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 fire. So just follow me on all streaming platforms. I be on Twitter talking shit, BL Sherelle 8. I be dragging everybody. So that should be funny. And then I'm on Facebook and Instagram. BLSHIRELLE. I ain't that good at that shit because, you know, I was in jail for a long time, but I'm trying to get my followers up.
Hey, get the followers up.
My name is Wonk Savage on Instagram. Y'all can follow me there at Wonk _ the Savage. On Facebook, it's Wonk Bell. You know, I don't do much. My entertainment, I'm near. Fuck that shit. But, you know, other than that, y'all, just be safe out here, man.
Absolutely.
Stay freed up. Absolutely. Stay blessed up.
And God willing, I'll be in Jackson, Mississippi, on March 16th, Jackson, Mississippi. I will be down there teaching the youth offenders how to song structure.
That's so what's up. That's dope.
Hopefully I'll be, you know, anybody in Jackson.
Shout out to Heaven Solutions, the queen of credit.
I'm Lolo the manager. You can follow me on Lolo _DA_manager. I sell eyelashes, hair, clothes. I have my own record label, Grind to Rise Entertainment. So,
uh-oh.
Who the sign up? Crown Me Who? Uh-oh. These y'all babies.
Yeah, that's what's up. Yeah.
Oh, and Shada Montgomery. Shada Montgomery on IG. Pushing Limits. What's your IG? Yeah, no. Yeah, Pushing Limits on IG. Y'all, remember this song? Remember this song, Limits? I promise y'all, it's one of the biggest records in the country. I swear.
Is it my turn now?
Oh, yeah. Go. Yeah. I guess. Go ahead.
Listen, yo. Y'all got me smiling in here. I ain't have to talk the whole time. They are killing it. Like, just let them go. Shout out to everybody that tuned into my live. We got everybody. Listen, this wasn't just the universe brought us together. Let me tell you, I handpicked this. Mm-hmm. We got BL in the building. Norf came through in the club.
Yeah.
We got Lolo over there. Crown Me Lashes. You got Wonk Bell over here. I just love her personal. I say, yo, this bitch be talking shit on the show. And here go. Yanabu?
Yes.
Can I say Yanabu? I like Yanabu.
Yeah.
Here go Yanbomb. I think that's her. Why don't you say Yanabu? Hold up the card. She do. Everybody in here, we are women. We all do something great.
Besides
the fact that we have great personalities, we all have something going on, if you notice.
Definitely do.
You see that? Hit her up, cleaning, cooking, whatever you need done, she's the one.
She like, I do everything.
We
might
as well do commercials.
She's a, yeah, she's like, I do everything. Yeah, definitely. That's definitely been a good day. Yeah.
We going on
4 o'clock.
What you doing?
Yeah, this is crazy. All right, y'all. I want to thank everybody for tuning in. And don't forget, March 15th, Friday, March 15th, my birthday party, 5301 Woodland Avenue, Black Inga be in the building, 5301 Woodland Avenue, Friday, March 15th, Black Ink will be in the building, and then Saturday the 16th, we're going to be right here at ABM101.com. Oh, sure to be here, a couple of surprises to be here, but they will be here tatting all day.
I need my butt done.
They're going to be tatting all day. That's March 16th and 17th, Black Ink will be in the building, you know, doing tats. We're doing spades and tats. We're going to have some games and shit like that. We're just going to have a ball. It's going to be on some grown shit. So that's March 16th and 17th. So make sure y'all come out if y'all know where it's at. That's abn101.com. And we out.